Carl, give me a house beat. Go like pff, 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 like that speed. I'm ready.
Alex is gonna have a lot of fun editing that together, especially with my lack of rhythm today.
I'm sorry for that. Also, my name is Curtis, and this is the Every FNFF podcast. Hello.
Hello, I'm Carl, and this is the Every FNFF podcast. With me, as always, is
Alex, formerly Big Man.
Hey.
And we have a new party member this week.
We do.
Hello.
Hey.
An actual Pulsion.
Keen listeners will recognize our guest's accent before they even introduce themselves.
It's been millions of years, and I finally come back after fulfilling my focus. So thank you so much.
Yeah, how'd it go?
Honestly, I don't remember a thing.
Well, we have on the show friend of the pod, Strunk Chonkler. What's going on, buddy? How you doing?
Great, thanks. Thanks for having me. How's all y'all?
Yeah.
Pretty good. Pretty
doing
good.
Doing all right.
Strunk is coming to us from the future, but to the listeners, it's from the past because we recorded this a little while ago. But you're how's tomorrow?
Honestly, bright sunny day, clear skies. The lottery numbers are 6 and 1, and that's it. That's all you need to know.
Nice. Yeah, that's 3 off from the number I always go with, which is 64 because it's the Nintendo number. But well, I'll get them next time.
Happens to the best of us, honestly.
Well, yeah. I feel like the first thing we always do whenever we have a new guest on the podcast is ask, "What is your history with Final Fantasy?"
So, back in the day when the PlayStation 2 rocked up, we were only just getting a PlayStation 1 because we were cool like that. And we borrowed Final Fantasy 9 off of a friend. And for all of you Final Fantasy 9 heads, we got all the way up to Black Waltz 3, the cutscene where we get like fly into Lindblom, and it crashed and it would like stop working. Yeah,
oh,
and so,
no.
we would replay it. We'd replay that entire first section every time. And we'd be like, oh, maybe we get a little bit further this time. And it never worked. And my mate was like, my brother's friend was like, no, you can just open the disc tray and close it and it skips the cutscene. We're like, oh my God, this fixes everything. And he was like, oh, can I have my game back, please? And you're like, oh, okay, all right. So then we went months without it. And my brother ended up buying Final Fantasy IX. Again, and that we jammed that, and then it's been years since really coming back, and then sort of I watched the 2019 GDQ of the 9 run, and I was like, mm-hmm. Oh baby, I'm back in, I can't stop. and then yeah, it's been Final Fantasy mania here, learning, you know, a couple of speedruns, learned 9, learned 5, learned 2. Easily the best 3, like top tier stuff there. That's sort of it. It's been a decent chunk of my life.
That's awesome. That's funny because the thing that got me into speedrunning at all was the GDQ run of 9, done by former guest of the podcast, Mutsky, no less.
Right? I reckon I've listened to that VOD so many times I could like quote it by now.
Wait, what's your favorite Eiffel 55 song?
honestly, it's
55.
It's too hard.
Is it My Console?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, absolutely.
That's awesome. You've run Final Fantasy 2,
yeah,
right? Did you 5 as well?
Yeah, ran 5.
I'm wearing my Final Fantasy 5 Unicorn
shirt. I noticed. I'm very embarrassed
right now. Thank you.
I tried to buy them, but obviously, you know, all these links go live at like 1 a.m. Australia time. So by the time I checked it at like 6 a.m., all of it was gone.
Oh, no, I got you.
Your experience with trying to get them is probably very similar to most people's, because I feel like that shit sells out pretty instantly anyway. So you like you put it in your cart and then you're like, and it's gone. It's already gone.
Who knew that Final Fantasy was such a popular series?
Yeah, we certainly didn't when we started this bullshit.
So
we're in chapter 7.
Yeah, much like Pulse. So I was realizing as I was thinking about Australia, how similar it is. Like, they could just be a straight up just analog to Pulse because, you know, a lot of people were purged there. There's a lot of scary animals down there.
Yeah, it's very true.
I was thinking, Have you beaten the whole game, Strunk?
No, I am up to essentially where we're up to now, and it's like the first time I'm playing it.
Okay, well, yeah, I want to ask you a question. Keep it in mind, and then let us know later, like when you get to it, right? So I've never been to Australia, but eventually we'll come to a town called Werribee. And I feel like in my brain, I'm like, this must be what Perth is like.
Ooh, okay.
So we'll see. All right, okay. Everybody, anybody who like is from there or has been there is listening to the podcast right now and is like, fuck you. I'm like, I'm sorry.
Why Perth and not like Darwin or something?
Because it's the only place that I know it's the largest city I know that's isolated from most of the cities.
That's very true. It's over the other side. Yeah. No one goes to Perth. And when people go to Perth, they stay in Perth.
Well, maybe it's not like that because I guess Vanille left, but whatever.
We're far away from Perth right now. We're in Palom Palom.
Oh, indeed we are.
Curtis, was that your Australia question that you wanted to ask Strunk?
No, that wasn't my Australia question. Okay, I have another Australia question.
Yeah, if you have that, because I too
Do you want to go ahead and do yours? I act like I've done one.
Please, now I'm full of Australian knowledge.
If you don't mind.
No, listen, I have all day for this.
Okay, so this is an important question. As our Australian correspondent, I'm going to show you a guitar here. And I just want you to tell me what the name of this guitar is, if you're familiar with the Powerpuff Girls.
If I do recognize this, definitely. It is the Mojo Jojo guitar.
Thank you. Thank you. Mystery solved.
I would know. The second question is, why do you have a guitar with Mojo Jojo on it?
Oh, man. Okay, so when I was in high school, I worked in a music shop for like 7 years. I wasn't in high school for 7 years, but I did work in a music shop for all of my high school years. And in the basement, we just had these weird Cartoon Network guitars that had like been there since that was a popular show. So by the time I started working there, it had probably been 7 years since those guitars came in, and my boss was probably like, oh, these will sell like hotcakes, and then they just sat there forever. And then
they're like 3/4 scale. I remember calling into the telephone because they were like giving those away one weekend on Cartoon Network, and I was like trying to get one.
Really?
Yeah. All throughout high school, I was like, I need to buy that fucking thing. And if I like, if I leave the music shop and it's not bought yet, I will buy it. But I can't like justify the cost or anything. And then I left and didn't really even think about it. And then I went back one day and I was like, yo, do you still have that Mojo Jojo guitar? And I went down to the basement. I was also buying another guitar that day, like an Ibanez that was a really nice one that shares a model number with one that's really not as nice. So anytime you look it up online, it's super cheap, but it's from like the run that they did that was really, really good from like the main factory or whatever. So I essentially got like 2 sick guitars for like extremely cheap as a combo thing because my old boss was just like, yeah, you know what? Just give me like, you know, 400 or 500 or whatever for the both of them and you can have it. And I was like,
oh, that's sweet.
Fuck yes, dude.
That's awesome.
That's wild. So, yeah. That's so cool.
Yeah, it is 3/4 scale. Friend of the pod, Robbie, who, you know, the founding member of Zaku, wanted to start a weird like quintet, I guess is what it would be called, like a rock band that does all kind of like classical music but on all guitars. So we would have to create alto guitars, which would be really light strings and tuned up a fifth so that it was, you know, playing on the A. So I got this and I was like, oh, like maybe this will work for it.
And also it looks sick as fuck.
It's such a cool guitar. It's really, really cool. I tried to tune it up that way, but the high E string just snaps if I tune it up too high. So
all right, I'm here for any more Australia questions.
Okay, one more, and then we'll get to the business. We'll get to our good shit. And I could be wrong about this, but in America, if you have like a sports team that you like, and you go to their games and you cheer them on, in America, our word for that is rooting. You're rooting for them. And my understanding is that in Australia, that has a slightly different meaning. And I just learned this the other day. So if you're like, I'm rooting my team, then like that is slightly different depending on where you are.
Well, it depends. Are you rooting your team? that is definitely different by a considerable margin.
Okay.
Although context is champion here. If I was rooting for my team, that also is probably a bit different.
Okay.
Oof. Yeah, not quite the same there, Curtis.
I just looked I looked it up, and it was pretty much exactly what I thought it would be.
Yeah, okay. No, you can get it from context. Yeah, it is. Yeah, no, listen, not quite the same.
I'd have to have all night to root my team. I mean, that would take a long time.
Well, it depends how many you're doing it once, I guess, yeah. Right?
Hey, we got all half time.
Yeah, exactly. What's that, 20 minutes, 30 minutes?
You got a lot of hands.
Silicon Valley did it. Lilly made a mathematical thesis. They released a 12-page thesis about how long it would take to root a entire auditorium, including everything from the height of the individual to how many people they actually hired mathematicians to verify all this data, and it's very essential to the plot of the show. It's ridiculous.
Well, I'm glad it all came together for us. Final Fantasy 13, what a game.
What a game.
What a game.
What a chapter, because we are still in chapter 7.
Oh my, we are still in chapter 7.
So I have a great story about how we got here. So I was...
This chapter freezes my browser because of how long the text is.
I was catching up with the podcast, and I'd been playing on Xbox Live because it had it on there. It had 12 and 13 and a bunch of other ones.
I think it's on its way out, so it's good.
Turns out it is on its way out. So I checked in on Friday, and I was like, cool, I'll just catch up. I've only got 3 chapters to go. And it wouldn't load. And then it kept trying to install random stuff, and I was like, what's going on? Turns out it's not on there anymore. So I had to buy it on Steam, and I jammed it. I skipped every cutscene. I was like, I'm gonna rush to get here. It took me 6.5 hours just straight up of just jamming over the past couple of days to get to this point. And I was like, oh, I wonder how long this takes in the speedrun. The speedrun finishes at 4.5 hours. And I was like, oh, ooh, okay.
You should have called Zwanzig up and had him help you.
Yeah, should have just had him over my shoulder. Oh, you could, just powerists, just level up all the powerists, go.
I've been contemplating doing the same thing because I, at the beginning of this month, I was like, oh, you know what? I could probably make a foolish financial decision in 3 to 6 months when the Steam Deck is available again. So I reserved one, and then
I think we reserved one while we were about to record.
Yeah, I was like, oh, yeah, whatever, fuck it. And then 3 weeks later, it was like, your Steam Deck is ready. And I was like, oh, okay. And I was like, well,
you
fuck
got two
it,
days to pull the trigger, motherfucker.
And today I was supposed to, it was supposed to arrive for delivery, even though I just fully bought it on Friday. So it's 2 days ago.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, I'm like, oh, cool. And then as I was getting ready to record, I have my headphones on and I hear my doorbell ring, and I'm like, oh my God, that's the delivery. I need to sign for it. So I jumped up, ran upstairs, went there. And it was just some guy who was standing in the rain with an umbrella. And he's just like, oh, I'm just going around to see if everyone's registered to vote. And I was like, yeah, we're registered. And he's like, oh, everyone in this house? I was like, yes. I was like, you don't have my Steam Deck. Get the fuck off my property. Yeah, so I'll see if I can beat Strong's time getting to chapter 7.
I believe in you, bud.
I think a few seasons ago, if I had to do something to change systems mid-season, I use a cheat engine so I can just one hit my way. So I'm just running through and just one hitting every enemy.
So I didn't realize until at the end of this chapter, I completely forgotten about Deceptisol. So I've been fighting everything on the way through.
Oh my God.
I just had no clue. Oof.
I refuse to use them because there's only so many. So I'm just no, I can't.
But it's also, whenever you die in a boss fight and it takes you back, and there's a cutscene pre the boss fight, does it last until you get it through the cutscene into the boss? Does a Fortisol last?
We'll talk about it. Actually, at this chapter, I will bring that up. And yes.
Okay.
The answer is yes.
I also found out that I just got Odin, and I got into a fight right afterwards, and Hope had perished, and I summoned Odin to finish the fight. And when Odin was done, Hope was alive again, and everyone was on full health.
Yeah.
I noticed
that in this episode when we get to the big boss fight at the end of this one, a similar thing happened where I was really struggling, and we'll get there when we get there, but I ended up summoning Odin as well, and then I realized oh shit, everyone's just full health now. That's really, really good.
That's crazy.
That's really nice.
I guess a hack if you are out of Phoenix Downs is just summon.
Once every couple of battles, you can...
Last we left, Fang and Lightning had a nice little conversation, and now we are, we're still under the bridge, but when we come up onto the top, we realize that we're just at the a very familiar area of Pelham Pelham when we were playing as Snow and Hope, but now it's like Golden Hour, and most of the enemies are the same. There's no civilians around anymore.
During the beginning of this section, because we begin kind of like off to the side of the main road, which is actually funny because like when we were here as Snow and Hope, I wrote down in my notes like, yo, some places just be going nowhere. Like, there's, like, catwalks that go nowhere. And then it turns out that's where we're starting the day at. Because I was like, oh, okay, that's for this cutscene. That's why this is here. But at the end of this is a set of ladders. And when you go up to ladders in this game, like, everybody just jumps all the way up them. And so I wrote in my notes, I was like, why do ladders even exist in this world? Like, if nobody uses them, they just jump up the
speed
whole link.
Tech,
well,
dude.
The developers had had already finished Dirge of Cerberus, and they're like, we need to fix
this. They're
like,
this. Yeah, ladders. The ladders were a big problem. Speedrunners are telling us how much they hate them.
Ladders are specifically for Snow in a little bit.
I was going to say, this is the point in the game in which I was like, I guess no one ever uses a ladder, and then put a pin in that for like 10 minutes from now.
Well, if you're on your own, yeah, I guess it works. If you got legs.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we come around that corner where I guess there would be a save point if we were playing as Snow and Hope, but there's now just like an Alpha Behemoth there.
This is as good as a save point.
Oh, the first thing I noticed with these fights was I really miss having double ravages. Like, double ravages just get stuff done.
Yeah.
But the second you don't have double ravage, you're like, oh, this is actually just really slow now.
Yeah, and like the two commandos, this is where they don't fight the same person.
Yeah, they
right?
attack different things.
Yeah.
So
which is, it's confusing at first, and you're like, oh, that's kind of cool, and then you're like, wait, all of my strategy involves on everyone looking at the same thing and fighting it.
Yeah.
I ended up having lightning with, like all the power. I had, like, a fully powered powerist. There's an item coming up that we get that I had, like, fully powered on lightning as well, and my whole goal was to, like, okay, just make sure lightning attacks everything, even if I'm not in control of lightning. Like, lightning needs to do all the damage.
Is the upcoming item the Axis Blade?
It is not, no.
It is not! Oh, okay, because that's the next thing I wrote down that we get in this section. Which now that I've brought it up, I'm just gonna go ahead and talk about it. In one of the treasure chests along the way in this area, we get the Axis Blade, which I did equip because I was like, I don't know how good this will be, but I'm interested in that every time you damage an enemy with an attack, lightning gets a little bit of ATB back. And I was like, okay, well, right. So like, even if it's, you know, 10 or 20 less attack, if I'm attacking that much more often, who the fuck cares? But after 4 hits with lightning, it only refills half of 1 ATB bar. So, like, it's not really that good. And I'm wondering if maybe when I upgrade it, it'll do better. But I don't know that that's the case. Interesting weapon that I do have equipped.
Hmm.
Yeah, I think from what I understand of it, and I could be completely misremembering or just completely wrong, I think it doesn't really have too much of a use. It sounds like it'd be really cool, but I don't think it's necessarily that good. Like you said, it doesn't do enough to kind of take the hit that you might take.
Yeah,
if it
gave me like a whole ATB charge for 4 hits, that's like just fast enough that I'd be like, all right, that's probably more on the output. But
you wait till you find out when lightning has 8 ATB, then it fills up the entire full ATB.
what item did you get for lightning strong?
Later on we end up getting the black belt, and so I just I leveled that up, and I have a note here that says black belt with power wristband can't die. It was perfect.
Yeah, black belt's like, what is it, like 50 attack or something? Or oh, that's defense.
No, it's defense.
Attack, yeah.
Someone mentioned a behemoth. I think it's the Lodestar behemoth, right?
Is that this one?
I think.
Is this the one that can fucking stand like a dude?
Yeah, this is the one that fucking stands like a
dude. Yeah, dude. These things, I did, and like I believe we talked about it on the podcast already. This isn't the first time that we're seeing this, but I completely missed it. I like wasn't paying attention. I was just like, these fights are like easy enough, whatever. It's just a behemoth left. I'll take it down. I didn't even notice that he had like stood up and became like more like an iron, like a classic iron giant or whatever from Final Fantasy games with the giant sword and stuff. And I was just getting like distorted. I was like, oh shit, this is actually a problem. I actually do need to pay attention because they, there's definitely a difficulty spike when he starts standing like a dude, standing like a guy.
Definitely an enemy that to me, needed to be slowed.
yeah, exactly. Which is nice because Fang does have, you know, the slow debuff in the, what is that, the Synergist or the Saboteur, I guess.
Oh, Saboteur.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's helpful. Like, what, Sap and Salve is the the Saboteur and Medic. So that's when, like, Fang is just putting on debuffs on everything while... Lightning is just making sure she stays
also
alive.
The behemoth gets its HP back when it starts to stand. It's a kind of an asshole. kind of a rough enemy.
Yeah, they definitely seem like ones that we should probably start avoiding if possible.
Wasn't there like a whole thing that says don't fight these if you've only got two people in your party?
Well, that was actually the
That was a scale beast.
I think those
are
the scale beasts, but
True.
This also seems like you might want to try and avoid them for sure.
He looks like that Pokemon with the who's a cat that's a wrestler, right? What was his name?
Meowth.
Yeah, that one.
Incineroar?
Oh yeah, Incineroar.
It gives me Incineroar vibes.
Best Smash character ever.
Yeah.
I heard looks like a wrestler and I just thought of Hawlucha.
Yeah.
Too.
I do like Hawlucha.
Yeah, like, why he has pretty good posture for a...
God, you said that, and I was like, oh, God, my posture. Ooh.
Yeah, I know, yeah, posture
yeah,
check,
I immediately am thinking about how fucking shitty my posture is.
But also when he stands up, his, like, he has, it looks like he has a crown or, like, antlers or shit like that. It's like
cool design.
Yeah, I just ran by him because he was in the corner, so I was like, nah.
Well, you just run to the right, and he charges, like, in a line, and you're like, well, bye. All right.
I refuse to skip anything in this game. I won't do it. I'm like, if it's there, it must be defeated.
Yeah, I'm pretty much the same. Especially in this section where you're like, okay, well, you know, the government has sort of taken over this place that's highly, like, a bunch of tourists, a bunch of innocent bystanders and stuff. I should probably not just let them run rampant with these monsters when there's civilians so close. And they've already said, like, oh, yeah, we'll just kill civilians. We don't care. Like, we're just going to, any means necessary, we're going to take down your party. So it's, like, it's kind of my duty to kill this horrible monster that's in the, you know, in the shopping district.
Well, I guess they have the mechanical parts, maybe. They're under control. I don't know. It doesn't matter. Knowing SICOM, they probably will turn
under control
them,
by
like,
the people who have noticeably yes, said, hey, we don't give a shit about civilian casualties. Fair, yeah. Just have fun out there, GLHF, dude.
So I think last episode we were, when we came through this area, like I noticed like all the beautiful like signage and stuff. It's really cool seeing all the, I actually sent to you, I found the textures for those signages.
Yeah.
And it's cool seeing like all the little things that they are actually have text on them. Like there's a sign with a pig on it that just says Pelham Pelham Supermarket.
I like the Buffalo Pharmaceutical Company.
The pet shop? Is that just a little doggo?
That one's a little spicy.
Yeah, it's a little dog.
thing from like, it looks like something out of like you know, Blade Runner. Mm-hmm.
That's really cool.
And then of course there's like the Guardian Corps signs and there's a Rainbow Bookstore. And then that one.
Oh, that's the Guardian Corps logo. Okay.
In the top right, there's just a guy standing there in a suit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sign I'm trying to figure out because it says, I translated it, it says like Knockert, Nocceert. And like, what the fuck does that mean? Is like a name?
Knockers?
Yeah, maybe Knockers.
It's the Pelham-Borum stripper.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, they have really good buffalo wings to pair well with the buffalo.
Pharmaceutical company. Yeah. I like the one that just says professional school.
One of them just says good.
One of them just says good.
Yeah, that's a so as we remember from Final Fantasy VII, they were really big fans of My Bloody
that's
Valentine.
Right.
In this, they were really big fans of Better Than Ezra, so they were like, we gotta put good. That's the Shakespearean play that they have in the 13 universe.
And there's like a few ads for this cool car that says like it's from this company called Unicorno or something like that.
Cornholio.
That's right.
But yeah, I thought those were cool. It's always fun seeing like all this just little world details and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Culture.
Yeah, it's really cool how much detail they put into like these small things.
Oh yeah, the Pelham Pelham, they really go hard on, for real.
Yeah, it feels like people live here.
Yeah.
But yeah, after we get the Lodestar, or after we pass the Lodestar behemoth, we walk up and down some steps, and we're on a bridge, and then a cutscene begins.
Yeah, and Fang and Lightning kind of take a breath, or like taking a moment just to talk to each other, and they're like, they're gonna get Snow on the phone, right? Like Fang's like, all right, time to call Snow, but the phone's still jammed, so they can't talk to him.
Freaking lipstick.
The fucking lipstick one.
Still hyper encrypted or whatever.
But Lightning asks Fang, she says, like, the others are safe, right? If any of us got caught, they would make an announcement. And Fang's like, yeah, they'd make an announcement. They'd have to let everybody know.
She's kind of laughing to herself. I'm like, yeah, they would. This is like,
yeah, they would. They'd have to let everyone know that the big bad Lassie can't hurt them no more. These cocoon people, bunch of cowards and blowhards.
Yeah.
And like, Lightning is like, yeah, well, these cocoon people, quote unquote, have spent centuries under Falcy law in constant fear. If it wasn't for Sarah, I'd have been out here too hunting Lassie. So like, yeah, I like that Lightning kind of stands up for Cocoon there, which I thought was like kind of neat.
Yeah.
She's kind of also admitting that this is just kind of the fear that we've been fed for so long. And so I can't tell how much of it is she's defending it or just like, well, can you blame him? They've been just like fed this like propaganda forever. Like I couldn't really quite get a read if she was like being empathetic or dismissive. I don't know.
And Fang says that like Grand Pulse is just as bad, right? She's like, that's exactly the same kind of thing that we heard. They said Cocoon's a floating nest of vipers ready to strike. Which I think is a good point.
Is Pulse still a like active? Like,
I was gonna say it's good to point out that Fang and Vanille were hearing that over hundreds of years ago. They literally say so. Like we don't know what the situation is there now.
But yeah, I was like, do we have any evidence to know? I just like realizing, like, wait, Pulse is like his own collective of people. Like, are there still people who live there?
Right.
Or not? Do we know that or not?
We don't know it. Yeah, I mean, judging from like what Fang and
Vanille
say, I'm
sure the people of the world would know, but like I don't know.
Yeah, at least when Fang and Vanille were there, it was that way, according to this, right? That they're saying like, oh yeah, that's what everybody just said there, or whatever. But it's been hundreds of years, so we don't really know the status of Pulse now. Because we have heard, I think Saz has said that it's been since the War of Transgression, since anybody's even heard anything from Pulse. Like, we don't know what it's like. There's no evidence of anybody coming here.
It could be completely just extinct down there, and we don't know. But maybe, like, the Sanctum is still, like, stoking the flames of fear just to keep people kind of in order.
Right.
It's like, oh, yeah, Pulse could strike at any moment. But, like, there could be no Pulse, and we wouldn't even know because we only hear everything through them.
Right. But, yeah, so Fang gives the floating nest of vipers analogy, and Lightning's like, okay, so you became a Lassie to fight those vipers, and destroying the nest is our focus now.
Because, yeah, they're all Pulse Lassie now.
They're all Pulse Lassie.
One of us.
They're all fighting on the same team. They're all rooting for the same team now.
Yeah. Nice.
Just, like, as God intended, you know?
At one point, I did, I was like, oh, you know what, Fang is kind of new to the party at this point, we got a lot of upgrade materials, let me see how I can do, like, an upgrade, and, I think Zwanzig is the one who pointed out to us that you can go up to 3x bonus, if you're upgrading, and I took the Bladed Lance, you know, her ripstick or whatever it was, and I just started leveling it up, and I was just kind of testing it out, and I got it up to level 4, and then I had the 3x bonus, and I upgraded it one more time, and I got it to level 12 with 88 plus strength and 57 magic, and I was just like, okay, well, I'm just gonna be using this then, because, like, anything I've gotten since, I'm like, this is probably really cool, but I don't feel like losing out on what I have right now.
I do like the constant, like, evaluating exactly how you want each character to be and use. I think it's, like, a really good strength of this game.
Yeah, I'm excited for it to, like, open up a little more so I can kind of try and actually make a build instead of just, you know, throwing shit onto a staff and hoping it makes it good.
That is also what I like about this game. Like, I made comparisons. Like, oh, yeah, this feels a little bit like 10, but, like, the way that this game does different than 10 is that kind of forces you to use every party member in some rotations. Have you just like treating your party like a Pokemon party, like, yeah, I'll have you guys in reserve or whatever, and like I'll pull you out if I need you kind of thing, and I'll just stick to these like main three guys for the entire
game. Not how you guys played Pokemon? I had like three like good people, and I was like, the other three are backups if I need to do anything. They can survive a turn, they can revive someone,
they're my HM friends.
Yeah, your friend with benefit, the benefit being cut.
Yeah.
Did you guys see the dog that's just standing between two blockades on one of the streets?
I'm missing every dog.
Yeah,
in this game.
I think it's the low poly dog.
I love him.
There's just like he's just between two things standing there, and I don't think anything happens with him. But I was just like, oh, he's out of my reach, so I can't pet him. But I like just looking at him.
You need a pokey flute to get by him.
I was gonna say now might be a really good time to talk about the voice acting in this game.
Yes,
because I have opinions on specifically two of them.
Oh yeah, that's a good point.
Well, I'm sure part of it, because we mentioned briefly that Fang, the voice actor for Fang, is not a native Aussie.
No, Fang is a Kiwi. I haven't heard Kiwi voice actors are great, because they are. They're generally fantastic. Like, most Kiwi voice actors are fantastic. Vanille, on the other hand, I have concerns.
Really?
And it's only because I grew up in a time when really young, like, childhood, like, teenage shows, like, you know, I don't know if you guys ever watched or have ever been shown a show called The Saddle Club. Marvel actor Chris Hemsworth's first appearance in a TV show.
Interesting.
Yeah, so this show is like the soundtrack, like this opening song is like every person my age knows it. But the only way I can describe Vanille's voice acting is it sounds like a childhood teenage show, like an actor, a child actor.
Okay.
Just saying the lines.
Mm.
And that's the only reason I can't get past like Vanille, because it just sounds like she's 12 and she's just reading the lines aloud.
Ah, interesting.
Interesting.
Yeah. Like they're not bad. It's just, I have this like, affiliation.
Yeah, I mean that completely makes sense.
She always feels the most cartoony out of everyone.
Absolutely,
to me.
Yeah.
And I guess for us that's kind of endearing, just because, you know, the accent. And talking with Corey on previous episodes, where he was talking about, you know, the differences in the Japanese version, where it's not as stark of a contrast as like, you know, an American accent versus like an Australian accent. It was just about kind of sort of regional dialect differences, and someone sounding more from the country instead of sounding like, you know, from another country entirely. So very interesting. That's super cool.
Mm. American voice actor. I wonder what else she's been in.
Speaking of American voice actors, I don't think we brought this up, but someone in our Discord pointed it out to us that the voice of Titus is in this game.
Oh yeah, someone did
as
say that.
As Birdie's dad, I think. Oh yeah, we were talking about when he's like, "Oh, I won't run this again."
I remember Birdie's dad.
James Arnold Taylor making a cameo.
I will never forget Birdie's
dad. Yeah, and I think he does a couple of like various voices of just background stuff in this game, which is super cool.
Yeah.
Now I'm looking up other things that the voice of Fang has been in. But yeah, she's American.
Oh, she's American. Does great Kiwi accent.
It's funny because I remember you talking about that, and I didn't know the characters like at the time when you were talking about the accents, I think. And I just remember being like, oh, I know he has an issue with one of the Australian accents. Let me see. And I was like, oh, she's American, so maybe that's why he doesn't like it. And I was like, damn, no.
Maybe that's why.
She's in the new Cyberpunk anime. Maybe I'll check that out.
Really?
Also in Yuri on Ice. And like, she's been in a lot of things.
That's cool. Either way. Yeah.
Either way.
So Fang, she kind of goes on this little story talking about having woken up on Cocoon in Crystal Stasis, right? She's like, we fulfilled our focus. We woke up here on Cocoon from Crystal, which means we must have completed our focus. But she can't remember what it was. She's like, yeah, I woke up and like, she says, I can remember my childhood. My childhood is as clear as day, but the one thing I need is just gone and blank, like an empty page. And so she can't remember at all, like what her original focus was.
I mean, every time I always think of something really good right before I go to sleep, and I can't imagine. Like,
you gotta keep the dream journal.
It's like when you think of like a good riff while you're at work, and you're like, "I'll remember that when I get home." You never do.
Totally relate. Yeah.
Imagine if you had slept for like hundreds of years, and like, well, it's gone now.
Oh man, my tummy hurts every time I wake up. I can't imagine waking up after 100 years.
What are you doing before you go to sleep? All I see is every morning these tweets. Woke up, tummy hurt, send help. That's all it is.
I really do tweet that like every day.
I will say that
it's because I eat a sandwich before I go to bed.
Curtis did say recently that he told the story about the pickles that he got at a show. We went to the Zaku show on Friday, and that band that makes the pickles was also playing, and I bought the spicy pickles and the garlic and onion pickles, and they're so fucking good.
They're so good.
I think it's Pickle Monster is the name of the pickle company, so... I think they sell them online, so shout out to them, because you should check them out.
I got the garlic and onion, made salmon burgers last night.
Oh, that's so good.
That was so good. Hell yeah.
So,
but anyway.
Pickle rant.
One thing I need is just gone, like these pickles.
So, yeah, the pickles, yeah. But yeah, so she's having, she can't remember anything. And she says Vanille's the same way. Vanille and me, we lost our past and our focus.
She also mentions that, like, she also doesn't know why your brand looks like this.
Yeah, yeah.
She's like, there's my brand. Yeah. It's all messed up. Like, she looks, says it kind of like, man, it used to look so cool, and now it's all fucked up. Like,
yeah.
It ruined my cool tat.
I
do like, oh my cred. Oh, my street cred is gone.
She sat in the sun too long after the tattoo was new and just sun damaged it, and the artist can't touch it up anymore.
Well, yeah, he's been dead for hundreds of years, so.
That's true, yeah. Lenny says, now you want to find them, talking to Fang about her memories, and she's like, you want to find them, be a pulse to see, an enemy of Cocoon. And I like that Fang's like, yo, pulse and Cocoon can rot for all I
so
care.
So good.
Like, I do not give a shit. She says, if I don't figure out our focus soon, Vanille is going to be a Seath. I'll tear down the sky if it will save her. And that's the end of the scene.
So good.
Good sapphic vibes.
I love that. Love it.
But yeah.
Yeah. Then we move on. We do a little more ass kicking.
More ass kickery. Yeah, we fight some tilters. There's fancy tilters, right?
the fancy tilters.
Yeah, mm-hmm. A little more branded. Like, you can tell things are getting stronger because they're either purple or they're gold.
Yeah. They're certainly different colors.
Orions.
Right. The Orions.
The Orions, yeah. Also handy to be slowed. Mm-hmm. Because those are the ones that started doing those, like, spark strikes or whatever toward when they have low HP.
Yeah, we mentioned that too. I think when we first,
yeah,
because they show up as soon as we get control of Fang and
yeah.
But we pass through the I think alleyway that would lead to the cutscene where Snow like did his whole like display of like getting people to evacuate.
Yeah.
But we're still in the alleyway and like Fang starts like, "Hey, Lightning," and she says, "Call me Light."
She's just letting everyone call her Light these days.
It's like, whatever,
love to
I'm,
see
going,
it.
I'm relaxed of it.
Did you see Vanille's brand? No. No, huh? Want to know how long until it's Seath City? Just look at your brand. You start getting more arrows, and then finally an eye. Once it opens all the way, you're done. Let's have a look.
As she's saying this, Lightning is actually like unzipping, because I forgot that her brand is like kind of like on her chest. And she has kind of like a sweater vesty thing, like with a turtleneck. And so we don't actually see it, but Fang is like, all right, let's have a look. Like, don't be shy, and kind of being a little quiet.
Yeah,
I'm like, yeah,
yeah,
Dix again, or, but we don't see it. But like,
yeah, she's like, nowhere near. You got time.
Yeah. Still, you never know.
Yeah.
Some people, it doesn't take so long. You get a nasty shock, it can speed up the process. Which I think we mentioned later, like, in the data logs, it'll say.
Yes, I love what the data logs say about it.
It's like trauma or stress can just like speed up the process. It's the opposite of crank.
It says in the data log, it's like some people get so shocked when they first become a Lissie that it just immediately turns them into
that's
a
so
Seath.
Unfortunate.
Oh no. Yeah, I know. I feel like that's a bad choice on the Falsies part. It's like, you should have picked the better one.
Oh,
there
it's
that's,
done now.
That's on right. You
find another one.
Yeah.
Just turns to dust.
Yeah, have you tried not being stressed about the death sentence I just gave you? Just drink some water.
Yeah, yeah.
Silly, just get 8 hours of sleep a night, exercise every morning, and you'll never become a Seath.
That's right. Yeah.
I've been doing my yoga exercises.
Have you ever done your low pog dolly pose before?
Yeah, that dog will never turn into a Seath. Yeah, if a person is branded has no idea that they've been branded, will they just never become a Seath because they're so chill? they don't have that.
Yeah, what if it's like on my butt and I don't know where it, like, I don't see it.
Yeah, if it's on like the back like shoulder blade, you never look there, right?
Yeah, you never know. So it just never advances.
Yeah, people who have like the "I'd rather be fishing" bumper stickers are like incapable of becoming Seath. They're just always chill because they know they're only like a weekend away from being able to go fish, you know. There is an interesting distinction here where Fang is saying like, oh, you know, I need to save Vanille and I need to get her home, and then Lightning says, to pulse, you mean? And then Fang says, to grand pulse.
Yeah the actual,
like, kind of correcting Lightning a little bit. And I think this might be the first instance of us hearing like grand pulse.
I think it might
is
be.
It like kind of a more formal name for it, maybe.
Yeah,
it's kind of like, I mean, I'm also wondering, like, when they woke up, grand pulse, maybe it's implying that maybe grand pulse doesn't really exist anymore. Is like,
yeah,
you wake up in new york
York, yeah. Or it's like or it could just be that she's pretentious and it's like, if you told someone from Britain, if you're like, oh yeah, you're from like Britain, right? And they're like, I'm from Great Britain.
Yeah. I'm from Grand Britain, thank you.
Yeah, but she says, I hear that Sanctum prevents people from leaving Cocoon. I'd like to see him try and stop me.
<That's>
so good, dude.
But yeah,
she says, oh, like, so that's your plan? Like, I wish I had one. Without
yeah, that's
Sarah,
right.
Without
yeah.
a future, there's nothing to plan for.
Right. And she kind of like muses. She's like, you know, we could just sit here and fight the Sanctum all day. And I mean, we could topple the government, but like, what does that do for us? It does nothing. I may as well be dead. And Fang's like, no, your sister, you have plenty to fight for. You need to stick around and fight it out so that you can see Sarah when she wakes up. And yeah. Lightning kind of takes that at face value. But knowing that Fang and Vanille were asleep for like hundreds of years, I'm like, I don't know about that.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know that Lightning has hundreds of years.
I guess she's just grabbing onto any kind of hope that she can get.
Yeah.
Since she's so hopeless, she just found out, oh, okay, so there's a way to not be a crystal after this. It's not just like a death sentence or whatever.
Yeah.
And then she's just like, oh, okay, yeah, like I will think no further on this about the person that I'm talking to who has had this experience, but it was 150 years ago
yeah.
or whatever.
I guess it's not even really a death sentence, right? You turn into a crystal and then eventually you'll turn back. So really,
yeah.
it's just a really long sleep.
Yeah, it sounds nice. Really, really long.
I mean, to be fair, Lightning and Sarah kind of have a kind of connected focus, so potentially they could wake up around the same time if they both complete it, right?
Sure,
yeah. Who knows?
How far have you been, Alex? Did you complete?
I've only done the next chapter.
Okay.
But as this is all going on, we see kind of those speeders fly ahead, and Lightning's just like, oh no, Snow, like they found him, and then they rush forward.
Yeah, we see we now know that this is not a concurrent thing. This is actually happening at the same time as Hope is, as they're talking like, oh, I don't know what to do. Like, Hope is there about to freaking like stab Snow in the fucking face.
Yeah, because we see the explosion on the building, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is the explosion that Hope causes? It's the explosion that knocks Hope off.
The gunship causes, that knocks Hope off the building.
The secondary explosion, which is weird that they didn't hear Hope's explosion first. It'd be cute if there was a little Easter egg and I hear a little like that. Just like a little pap. It's like, what was that?
Sounded like a bird hitting a window. And you're like, oh, that's happening right at us.
But we cut away momentarily to Snow and Hope laying unconscious in an alleyway.
By some crates. Lovely little crates.
Yeah.
It took us this long to find a crate in this game.
But
what do you call that? Like how long you can rate it? There's like the crate rating system for like how long it takes to find a crate in a video game.
I don't think I've heard
familiar
of
that.
Might be a shooter thing. I forget.
The crating system.
I guess that was a crate joke there, Curtis.
Yeah, thank you. I see what you did.
But yeah, so Snow is the first one to come to, and he looks over and sees Hope, and Hope is like completely out. And you know, like there was a tense moment that just happened, and I think this really speaks to Snow's character, where he was just staring like death in the face, basically, like Hope was going to kill him, and he knows all the context of why Hope wants to kill him and everything. And he just goes right up to Hope and like hoists him over his like shoulders, like he grabs his arm and giving him kind of like a piggyback ride, and just kind of starts like moseying on out of there, trying to escape with Hope and
he's
continue
like,
protecting Hope.
And he's like clearly injured too.
It looks like he's got like broken ribs or a tummy ache, perhaps.
Or a bad tummy ache.
He just woke up, so fair enough.
Wow, we have more in common than I thought.
But yeah, as he's kind of like...
I would have a tummy ache too if I chugged a whole can of milk and then fell like 5 stories.
But as he's kind of like reeling over and like catches himself while he's holding Hope, he looks down and he sees the knife and he picks it up and he's like looking at it and he recognizes it. Like, obviously he knows. He's
like, huh, he got the same knife that I got.
Wow, this is a popular knife.
Yeah, everyone was asking for him that year.
Yeah, he just kind of puts that in his pocket and then, continues on with Hope.
Yeah, and he's like, he's limping along. It's rough.
Yeah.
And we get another stretch of playing as Lightning and Fang. Mostly the same.
Oh, yeah, now we're like in another cool, like, really, I don't know, a pretty area. I think we're kind of coming up on like...
I think we're in the
residential block. This is the Felix Heights, like
We're finally in Felix Heights. Yeah,
this does feel like the kind of like a lobby or something that leads to like some more residential areas.
Right.
I found the system. It's called Start to Crate. It's like a speedrunning. It's a speedrunning category, like how long it takes to get from the start of the game to finding the first crate in a game.
That's awesome.
And some people say like 17 seconds in Goat Simulator or whatever.
Try not to crate challenge.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so we kind of just go around and get into a couple more battles and stuff, just with, you know, more SciComm.
This area is beautiful. It's like getting dark because I think the sun's going down. So there's like just beautiful, like kind of golden light and speckling through. Like it almost feels like this would be kind of, everything looks like marble, but kind of sand marble. Mm-hmm. It's very, has kind of like a Croatian inspired like color palette going on.
It's very nice though. There's a lot of like terraced and latticed walls and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. There's a hallway in which we kind of walk down and there's like long shadows being cast or whatever. But at the end of it is a soldier and a behemoth. And I was just like, uh-oh.
Oh, yeah, I think that's the last battle we can fight in this
area.
Yeah.
Yeah. See another behemoth and be like, shit.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, that soldier's not anything.
Oh, that's
like, oh, fuck the behemoth. Though.
Yeah. I do like that. It's like a behemoth, but also just like a dude. And like the dude goes down immediately and then it's just a battle with the behemoth.
A man and his dog.
Yeah.
I think when I was speeding through this one run through, I was able to only fight one battle, and it was like one guy in a hallway, and I was able to avoid everyone else somehow.
That's awesome.
Nice. This is the area you get the black belt as well.
Ah, okay.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah, there are some hidden items around these like little corridors.
Yeah, you can get a tungsten bangle, and there's also a weapon that you can get for Fang, which I did not use because I had a level 12 thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
I also noted that the battle music is different in these.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, that's beautiful. It's still playing the kind of very, like, uplifting kind of emotional orchestral music that I think carries over from the previous cutscene. But we're kind of coming up to, like, this emotional kind of juncture because we're getting closer and closer to Hope's home and, like, Snow is kind of, you know, he's carrying this whole chapter, I think, is him kind of coming to his emotional climax to where he's like he's carrying the weight, literally carrying the carry.
the weight of his actions.
Yeah,
exactly. He feels guilty and also indebted to Hope, and like all this stuff is kind of happening at the same time.
Right.
It's really cool. Yeah. I like it.
What we were saying earlier about the data log entry about the brands, it's pretty cool. If you look at that, it actually shows you a bunch of the different forms of brands and like the eye opening and just like getting more and more red and everything. So.
Oh, yeah.
And you kind of can see, like, it's been a long time since we've seen a Seath, but, like, you can kind of see how their design kind of looks like the brand. Like, when it takes them over, like, the eye, like, you know, that, like, red thing that would be in the center of their bodies kind of reminds me of the brand.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Every time a new entry opens up in history and myth, I'm always like, yes! Let's go! That's
give
the
me
good
all
shit.
That shit.
Yeah. It's like a new one opened up in events. You're like, ah, events. I played events. I know what events are.
I have not read any of the events or any of the...
Those are just recaps. It's
I mean,
fine.
I've read them when I would start the game when they scroll by hilariously fast.
I still read them every time. I always pick it up and see what it says. Should.
The trick is never stop playing and you never have to read them.
Exactly.
There you go.
Once I get my Steam Deck, I will I will definitely never stop playing.
Wow, 200 hours played on 13. This is crazy.
But yeah, we finally get back to Snow.
Yes, yeah. So we get back to Snow. He's carrying Hope.
And we will take it out now because he is climbing up a ladder.
He's climbing up a ladder. God damn it. As soon as I thought it, I was like, there he goes, climbing up a fucking ladder.
This is some high stake ladder climbing.
I know.
It looks like a sewer ladder, you know, not like a, it's just like, what's it called? Like poles sticking out of the wall.
Mm-hmm.
Completely vertical. Yeah. Like, have you ever tried climbing one of those? It's kind of difficult.
Yeah. Yeah.
Curse and I have when we were climbing around the warehouse.
That's right. Yeah.
But imagine carrying a like 13-year-old child on your shoulder while you're doing
it. Yeah.
While also having fallen from the top of a roof.
With a tummy ache.
Yeah.
With a tummy ache.
With a milk tummy ache.
Oh, no, it keeps getting worse.
It's also, I don't know if I mentioned it on the podcast, but it says it's milk soda. So that was carbonated milk.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, right? Because you hear it open, right?
Yeah, well, it doesn't sound like a good combo.
No, they sell a drink called Milkies. They sell them at the deli near where I work or whatever. They're actually pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
Like carbonated milk, actually, kind of good.
I don't believe you.
Says the man who wakes up every day with a tummy ache. Big tummy ache has gotten to Curtis, and he's trying to shill for them.
That explains so much.
Big tummy ache. Damn. Anyway,
But when Snow gets to the top, he's on the roof and kind of looks over, and there's some commotion going on, and he's like, "Oh, that must be light."
Yeah.
Like, can kind of tell that she's around as well.
Yeah, there's some explosions probably happening across the way where we're fighting behemoths, I'm assuming.
Yeah, exactly. He's like, oh, that must be light. And then he just sees a behemoth getting launched up into the air and then lightning jumping up and attacking him and then Fang jumping up and attacking him. And he's like, ah, they seem to be doing okay.
I'll mention it later, but it's very convenient that every time we fight somewhere, they make sure the roof is high enough because
I wanted to point that out in the probably the area after our break mm-hmm. today. But yes, yeah, so Snow puts a Hope back on his shoulders. He starts walking and Hope starts coming too, right?
And, yeah, Hope is now awake and he's just like he looks shocked. He's like, why did you save me?
Yeah.
And Snow,
the last thing he remembers is trying to kill him.
Yeah. And Snow is just like, oh, I was asked to protect you. I was asked to save you by Lightning and by Nora.
I'm sorry. What happened? It was my fault. I put her in danger. I know that. Let me make things right.
And Hope's just like, you told me before that you couldn't. And that words were useless and a lot of other things I shouldn't have said.
I said the dumbest shit I've ever said in my entire goddamn life. Don't listen to a goddamn word I say ever.
If you're not first, you're last. That doesn't make any sense.
Look, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to set things straight, so
I didn't know how to set things straight, so I didn't. Like, I thought if I couldn't make it up, if I couldn't make up for it, all the apologies in the world wouldn't mean a thing.
Yeah, and so I decided I had to find a way to pay for it first before I even had the right to say sorry. But it's like you said, I was using that as an excuse so I could run from my own guilt. I hit home. So yeah, like this is all just him kind of summing up like
his own
faults that he's realizing. Yeah.
Very similar to Lightning, where Lightning was just like, oh, if I have a mission, I can keep going. I can keep running and I can keep like moving on.
Yeah.
Snow has a similar thing where he's just like, oh, if I don't have like any plan or anything, I don't have to worry about, I can just run from my own guilt. Like I don't know how to fix things and I don't need to think about that at all. Yeah. And now he's like realizing that's a really shitty way to live, especially when you're endangering the lives of everyone around you.
Yeah.
When you're Philadelphia, you just join five bands.
I never worry about my guilt. I always have band practice. But yeah, he apologizes again. He gives Hope Lightning's knife back, and he lets him know, because Lightning never told him what the deal with the knife was. And so Snow's like, oh, that was actually a present from Sarah, and if she trusted you with something that important, you should be the one to carry it. So he gives him the knife back, and like,
yeah, and then he says something super sick as well.
I was gonna say, while he continues to talk, Hope starts kind of like fiddling with a knife too, and like looking at it and stuff like that.
Yeah,
you could just stab him in the back of the neck right
easily.
Now.
Yeah, I've written perfect. Here. It's like easy access to slitting Snow's throat when he's on the back.
I think that's intentional, right? Like, I think that's a very intentional choice. That like he's like, here you go, and he even says, he's like, if nothing I do is good enough, I'll take any punishment you want to dish out. So he just and Hope just goes, she's gone, Snow. You can take the blame as much as you want, but that won't bring her back. And you can see it on Snow's face. He's like, oh, I'm sorry. He's like, oh, this kid's still riding my ass. But Hope's like, you know, I've always known that. Like, that's a thing I've known. And I just needed to blame someone to keep fighting. And Snow tries to be like the bigger guy. And he's like, oh, well, it wasn't just someone. It was me. You can take it out on me. And,
Yeah, keep yourself alive until you do it. In a way that I think Snow knows that it's not just his fault. Like, obviously, he is to blame, but he also, it's the Sanctum who did it and stuff. But he's like, this kid has a single focus, and if it's going to keep him safe and keep him motivated, then he can just blame me all he wants. And I love that earlier he was saying, like, if I can't make things right, then I accept any punishment that you are willing to give out. Like, but we just need to focus on the here and now and keep going. So he's like, let your hate for me like fuel you. That's fine. Like, we're just gonna keep going. Yeah. Like, I just need to keep you alive.
And during this, I really like this thing, because like this whole time, Hope's been like fidgeting with the knife or whatever. He just closes it entirely. Like, he's very slowly and very like purposefully closes the knife and puts it away, right? So it's like very symbolic of like he doesn't desire that revenge anymore, which I was like, that's so tasty. Such good direction.
The dish of revenge is suddenly starting to warm up a little bit. It will no longer be served cold.
Yeah.
That's what people don't understand, is revenge should actually be served warm, actually. Yeah, of course. Revenge is served warm.
Yeah, it makes sense.
But he, his injuries kind of catch up with him, right? And he needs to put Hope down, which I wrote in my notes, because the whole time they're talking, Hope still is like riding on Snow's back, and I was like, Hope, just walk.
Yeah,
like, you're fine. Like, he's clear.
Yeah, Snow's lumbering down like stairs and shit.
He's going down
Hope
stairs.
Has an open knife. Like, he could have easily just tripped and then like, whoops, knife in your head.
I thought they were. I thought he was gonna trip. I was like, oh my god, it's gonna be very emotional. Yeah.
I've got it here. I was like, Hope is a medic. Why doesn't he just heal Snow?
Snow has such a bad tummy ache. Get off that, man.
But he tumbles and but he's like basically dragging himself across the ground and gets like, he just barely is able to stand back up on like a pillar that's nearby.
Yeah.
And we're in another suspicious opening clearing.
Yeah, another suspicious clearing. Yeah. Because
it's like, look at that, you don't even need any help. Like, just like looking at Hope as Hope is just standing up.
And
like,
it's just
doesn't have any broken anything.
Snow kind of props himself up against the wall a little bit and says, let me catch my breath. And then did we already fight it already? Is this the second time?
Yeah. This is the thing that we fought earlier.
This is what made him thirsty in the first place.
What was the name of it? Do y'all have it?
Ushgal Subjugator?
That's right.
Yeah,
Ushumgal. Yeah.
Ushumgal Subjugator.
Ushugal.
It's apparently in the Annihilator class, which is where the Manus Fiend Warmech is apparently also part of that subclass, which I'm guessing they're just some sort of mostly technology, maybe not based on any sort of like modified creature, but it's just like a weird amalgamation of tech that they've turned into just a killing machine.
Yeah. Snow sees it coming, and it's like, it's zooming in, coming in for its revenge because we didn't finish it off. And his face just looks, he's like, oh, fuck.
Yeah,
dude,
it does look like that. He's like, god damn it.
He knows what it is, and he's just like, oh my god, dude. Like, but he calls out for Hope and he's like, get back, I got this one, and just immediately gets fucking punched
he
and
just gets
thrown
owned.
Into a pillar, and is just, he's out. Yeah. Like, he's, and Hope just says, always the hero. You want to die? And then, like, Hope gets to his feet. He's holding the knife, which is funny because he just puts it in his pocket. I mean, the knife's not really gonna help at all, but he says, like, oh, you want to die? And then he says, you can't. And he starts walking forward, and it just says, battle team changed in Hope, Ravager. And you're just like, dude, I have to fight this fucking thing.
I also like
with
that,
only Hope. Oh my god.
I like that when he says, like, he's talking to Hope or he's talking to Snow, like, and he's like, you want to die? You can't. He goes, I won't let you. And I was like,
it's so good.
That's so
good. He says that right as he's facing up against this fucking gigantic boss that we've already gotten our ass kicked by.
Now, I will say,
I wonder if that's supposed to be kind of some subtext, because, like, I think part of Snow's guilt is like kind of what flings him into like danger. Mm-hmm. So he can kind of feel better at himself by kind of using himself as like kind of take the hit and like be, you know,
he's just dumb.
It's like, you idiot. Like, stop trying to be a martyr, basically.
But so this battle starts and we're in a one-on-one situation. Like, Hope.
No paradigms, just a roll.
No paradigms. Hope versus the Subjugator. And the thing was, and I wrote this down in my notes too, I was like, I could have owned this guy with just Hope.
I was like, oh my god, you could just do this, right?
You could just do this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hope is just an absolute motherfucker and could take this dude down. Now, it would take for fucking ever because there's no way that you could, like,
target time is 2.5 hours.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
I do want to say that when we say it would take hours, it's level 55 and it has 378,000 hit points.
Yeah. Like, you'd never be able to do it, but because Hope has a bar fire and protect and shell, like, the Subjugator couldn't do shit to me. I mean, I could do turns on turns on turns before I needed to heal. So I was like, hey, if I just had infinite time to sit here, like, Hope would be okay. Like, he could take the Subjugator on if I just kept up the buffs.
Has someone done, I'm sure someone's probably done that, right? Like, is that possible?
No. 'Cause
spoiler alert, this is kind of a fight where it's expected there's going to be a mandatory loss.
I didn't lose. It's just over an amount of time, eventually.
I think once you get to a certain percentage or whatever, it, like, shifts
over. So, for me, I got to one HP left of hope in that I was about to just, like, I took enough damage that I should have died, but the game subtracted one and left me with one. And that's when the next scene happens where Fang and Lightning run in.
Okay. Because I was going to say, with the, if you have all of your buffs up, then I don't think he can do more than like 50 damage at a time, like max. So I was just
even with the targeted fight, whatever.
According to the ancient data logs at gamefax.gamespot.com. Damn, did GameSpot buy GameFax? Interesting. Is it possible for Hope to beat the Ushumugal subjugator alone? And apparently no.
Yeah, yeah. Because I ever maintained green HP pretty much the entire time. And
so, yeah, on the wiki it says, Hope begins the battle alone, but after his HP is reduced below 2%, or he brings the subjugator to 99% of his max HP. So if you knock off 1% of
damn,
its HP,
nice.
Whichever comes first. Okay.
Sure.
Because I was like, I'm going to do it. I'm not going to let Lightning and Fang come. I'm going to sit here all day and take this dude out.
I just finished work. I've got nothing to do tonight.
I got nothing to do. I'm ready to sit here all night.
Listen, it takes less time than beating Penance in Final Fantasy X, I'm sure. So it's fine.
Oh, that really did take a whole film.
I would imagine that the speed tech for this is to just take enough damage to force the next phase. Yeah.
The difference in this encounter is that it is on the ground the entire time instead of flying.
Yeah.
So you can use, you might be able to use launch, I think. Which I think I did when the second phase.
When
Fang and Lightning came around.
Yep, so
I was
can.
Actually able to juggle them for a bit. Yeah. It was real fun.
It took about 3 staggers, and each time I got the stagger to like 960%. And so so the launches were like just so much damage.
Before we even get to like that part, like I love that, Fang and Lightning catch up, and I love that it's like in battle. Like I love that the cinematics kind of blend in, and the camera movement just seamlessly transitions into the battle camera. It's
a
my
really
favorite
good
thing about
moment.
This game.
Yeah, it's really
where
good.
Like you think you're in a cutscene, and all of a sudden like it says scene change over his text, and then all of a sudden we're in battle without having a single cut or like transition or anything.
It's very elegant.
Yeah, it's so tasty. But Fang comes in like, not bad, kid. And Lightning's like, where's Snow? Like he's okay. And Fang's like, so sure you're up for this? Thing will never know it hit. I think she's like, Fang's talking to Lightning.
Yeah.
And that's where we see a party change, and there's all three of us, and it's great.
It's so
that we're
good.
Like, we're all in this
and
together.
And we absolutely rip up on this dude.
Yeah, this thing is no longer a threat.
Yeah.
Both my moms are here.
And yeah, like you were saying, Strong, you can get this thing like to max fucking stagger.
So much.
Yeah. That fucking 1000% damage stagger gauge. Incredible.
Wild.
Love it. I didn't do it. I don't think I did it yet, but I have done 5 digits of damage now. Look at this game.
That's amazing.
It's incredible.
I love that this game is just about like just throwing math equations at an enemy until
I like
fucking break it.
I like the way that this game is about like kind of choosing your moment in a way or whatever. Like you just don't do that much damage until they're staggered, but when they are, you're like, all right, damage now, like throw it out there.
Yeah, in a fight like this, you're like, okay, Hope just used his Ravager attacks. We launched it, like, Lightning launched him into the air, and now I am just going to attack and just keep it, like, everyone taking their turns to just consistently do DPS. Instead of doing, like, a big bulk attack, like, all, you know, what would it be, like, 12 or whatever, or, like, 11 attacks that you can do all at once. It's just, like, one by one by one by one by one, and just keeping it up in the air is so good.
Yeah, I was, like, doing, like, 2 attacks at a time to make sure that it was staying launched, and then waiting for, like, Lightning to come in, and then waiting my ATB, and then doing that kind of thing.
Yeah, time ups the ATBs are just kind of just
absolutely
exactly one half.
So good. It's so satisfying.
Fang and Lightning just passing them off to
now,
each other.
This boss this time does have a move called Photon Blast. That will
Photon Blaster,
yeah, that will fuck your team right up. It does a lot of damage, less if you have, your shell protect up. But you can with Fang get him to aim it at Fang, and like maybe one of your characters will be out of the way if she's in Sentinel. And so
yeah, provoke Sentinel and Meta Guard and all that.
Yeah,
so that was a really fun fight. I didn't really have too much trouble with it. I don't think
very satisfying. Mm-hmm. These two-part boss fights are really fun.
Yeah,
I wasn't expecting this thing to come back so quickly. I guess I was just kind of thinking of like Evrei or whatever from Final Fantasy X, where I was just like, now it's back and it's like chapters later or something, and I had already forgotten about this boss or whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was very excited to see how this all played out.
But
once we're done, yeah, right.
I love this cutscene so much. Like, the beginning of this cutscene is just fantastic.
Yeah, everyone catches their breath and
everyone gets 5 stars. Everyone hit their target time.
Hell yeah!
Hope just turns to lightning and gives back the knife. And she
and I love what the way he says his first line. Yeah, he hands back the knife. He's like, Operation Nora didn't work out.
Yeah, I love that. And Lightning's response is really good too. She just
moved. She's moved by it.
Very caringly, just grabs him and gives him a huge hug.
Yeah, I love it. I love that because you feel that you can feel like Lightning's emotion there and how she is like moved by what Hope has just said. Like, because that's their biggest concern, and she realizes that he's let go of that anger now. It's so good. Mwah! Chef's kiss.
He's facing the reality of it. It's like, yeah, you'll be fine. It's because once you get you let go of the revenge, you're also kind of accepting
grief. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you're saying it's the stage of grief, the acceptance
part. Yeah, and Lightning just says, "You'll be okay. I'll keep you safe." And Hope says, "Lightning, me too. I mean, at least I'll try. Mm-hmm. I'll try to watch out for you too."
I love this weird, fucked up family.
I know. I love it. Everybody's kind of finally coming together as a team, and it's really exciting, with the exception of Vanil and Saz.
Yeah.
Right now,
but they're just a dynamic duo on their own.
Oh, in my brain, I'm still I love that everybody's coming together and we're all becoming one big happy family. However, Vanil and Saz have some rough fucking water ahead.
Yeah, dude.
I love this too. What you're probably about to say the same thing when they let go of their hug. Lightning kind of gives her gives a Hope a sisterly kind of just nudge on the fucking forehead.
Yeah, just kind of almost a little flick.
It's great. They're really starting to kind of.
Yeah, it's really cute. And then
really care about each
Fang
other.
Interrupts that moment and just says, "Don't forget about this one." And she just leaned over towards Snow, who's just fucking fully out on his ass, just knocked out.
Yeah, Lightning's just yeah, he'll be all right.
Yeah, that one will be all right.
Yeah.
He's too stubborn to die.
Yeah.
Bringing it back.
I love the recontextualization of that line.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
Because last time it was just complete
contempt.
Fuck this dude. He won't fucking die. And now he's yep.
Yeah, he won't die.
Yeah, and then we get some more Vanille narration. She says,
"Yeah,
knowing you'll always be welcome, no matter how much has changed, that's what having a home is all about."
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's kind of the theme of family and home. It seems to be kind of coming together right here.
Yeah, right as we're about to get to Hope's home.
Yeah, we're in front of his house now.
The music's still going.
Oh, the music is swelling. Yeah. It's so good. It's very emotional. Ooh, it's got me going.
We're now playing as Fang in the entryway at the S-Time residence right here in Palampolam. Is it beautiful? The sun's going down. We're in a glass kind of corridor leading up to the front yard garden.
Yeah, yeah. Hope kind of lives in a nice place.
Yeah, a little posh.
He has an item chest right in his yard, which is nice for us.
Yeah.
Containing a nice little tuft of phoenix down. I remember being who the fuck would just keep something like this in their yard? And then I'm like, well, I guess emergency thing like a phoenix down would make sense to...
When you get stung by a bee in the yard. But yeah, Hope is just standing in front of the door at the house,
yeah, so we,
ready to be interacted with.
We run up to him and then it kicks off the cutscene where he goes up to his ring doorbell and touches it and it glows blue and then the door opens and we see Hope's dad.
Yeah, Hope's dad runs out. Who's
This is Bart.
Yeah, it's Bart. My son's name is also Bart.
This is the Bart 1 that everybody talks about in Final Fantasy 13. It's so difficult.
Yeah, his name in the Japanese version is actually Butztholomew.
I get his actual name in Japanese is Baruto Romei.
Hmm.
Bart LeMay. Interesting. Anyway.
But yeah, he comes out completely frazzled, which makes sense because he probably saw the broadcast that.
Oh, you're probably right. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like, what the fuck?
What the fuck is happening?
It's not only is there a military occupancy, but he saw his fucking son being hunted down by SICOM on live television.
Yeah.
And so he's completely ready for any news, but probably relieved as fuck that his son's back. But Hope just says nothing but. Just mom's gone.
And that's the end of the scene.
it's heartbreaking, but
it's good.
It's such a sad but comforting because
he's home. Yeah,
he's home and this is information that needs to be delivered,
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
and on that super good note, yeah, well, I think it's a perfect time to take a little break.
Yeah, I think we'll hang around in Hope's home for a little bit, just kind of shoot the
shit. Go rooting around through his stuff, you know?
In both ways.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. See what old SNES games he has.
What's the Wi-Fi password? So we're all on our phones on the couch, probably.
Yeah. We're a little awkward, you know, like
we got the Wi-Fi password to the Estime house.
We're finally checking Twitter.
Yeah, they didn't tell us. They're preoccupied with something, so I had to go up to the router and look at the side, and I was like, okay, it's hot dog 13 fiscal 9. One of these nonsense fucking Verizon passwords or whatever.
I thought you were using like the phonetic alphabet for the Final Fantasy 13 universe.
It actually took me a little while to realize that Hope and his dad are in a separate room. I thought they were in the living room for the longest time, but they're actually like in a room directly across from the living
room. It's
like
a study or something, yeah.
Yeah, we get
like a sweeping shot of just this room, and the first thing we see is a framed picture of Nora, and then it kind of just zooms over, and we see Bartholomew just with his hands in his head, very upset.
I like this Rocko's Modern Life looking couch.
Yeah. Very Hey Arnold room.
Hell yeah.
It looks like Bartholomew's probably been crying, right, over the loss of Nora.
Yeah, of course. I think he's also sniffling a little bit.
Yeah. And Hope doesn't quite know what to say to him. And so he's just like, Dad, I'll be in my room. We'll rest up and then we'll leave.
Real Lisa Simpson energy.
Yeah. If they find out that you're sheltering Lassie, they'll... And he cuts Hope off and is like, you're my son. This is your home. And yeah. I was like, oh, okay, good. Bartholomew based. Incredible.
It's like, no. You're not going anywhere.
You can't do it, kid. Yeah, like we're expecting like a shitty father of Final Fantasy.
You can do it, kid.
You can do it, kid. This is your home.
Well, I think that's the thing is like we don't know about Bart yet. And everything we've heard.
I think we just know that he's more of just... I mean, I'm sure this is kind of a common-ish thing in, like, Japanese culture, is that the kind of trope of the occupied, overworking dad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's probably more absent from Hope's life. But during this, like, time of crisis, like, you can tell he cares. He's not totally, like, up his own ass, like, Jekt, who's just, like...
Right.
...completely preoccupied and having the time of his life.
Yeah.
Too busy having fun and kicking ass to take care of this snot-nosed punk.
Making Jekt shots 16s.
But Hope sits back down with his dad on the couch with him now, and, Bart... I just kept calling him Bart either way, but Bartholomew just says, my son, and Fang outside is, like... completely warmed and like charmed by this. Like, this is great. Like,
yeah,
I love
she
this.
Loves like, the drama, dude.
She's yeah, like it's just it's comforting. Like, yeah, he has a home. They like Fang and Vanille might not have a home, right? As far as we know, because who knows? But
this is the first time in the game anything has been remotely cozy. So like it is nice to be like,
even though we're kind of in this grieving moment, like everyone's kind of in this safe place together.
I mean, it's literally the first time anybody's had to rest since. The beginning of the game.
I think Fang.
No one's taking a pee break.
I think Fang also
it's
says.
Been 3 days.
Well, I mean, we were in the back alleys of Balampolam. Come on, we know that. People.
Carbuckle has to live off something, you know. So.
I think doesn't Fang.
Let's see,
like,
magic uses piss like for all your water-based magic.
That's so efficient.
What do you think Asuna is, dude? It's just Hope throwing piss in your face.
God, this is just TF2 all over again.
Oh my God. Did you guys watch Nathan For You?
I've seen a couple episodes of it.
The
guy at the gas station who says he drinks little kids' piss to like feel better. Alex, I'll let you just splice in the thing. I think it's the only time I've ever seen Nathan Fielder break character because he's just so genuinely blown away by it. He's like, what the hell are you talking about? Who's
apparently it's a cultural
drinking?
thing, like a yeah, it was revealed like it was kind of like the urine of like youth is young like supposed urine. To have like healing properties or whatever.
Is that like the 20th century version of like bathing in child's blood?
Maybe.
I think bathing in child's blood is the 20th century version of bathing in child's blood.
It's a lot more wholesome and cruelty free than
what
that.
What is adrenochrome when it comes from piss? urinochrome?
Yeah, urinochrome.
but when Fang, you know, is watching this very touching moment that we're literally pissing all over, I think she genuinely goes, phew, like she like is like so relieved. I think she like makes a little like sigh of relief.
I think we get the kind of phew moment in the next scene.
Yeah.
Because everyone is maybe like that's taking it, a breather. Which we'll come to. But yeah, she's smiling, but now we get to play as her as they're just kind of doing their thing.
Yeah, we get to snoop around the house and
look around the house.
It's a nice house.
I'm trying to find the sauce packets that, you know, they get from Taco Bell and just have in a drawer somewhere, even though they're never going to use
them. Yeah, where's
the
junk drawer? This place,
actually, where the hell is his kitchen?
I don't know if there is one.
I was looking for it as well. I was like, maybe they just always order in.
There's only bedrooms.
A friend of the pod, Corey, has been apartment hunting in New York City, and it seems like pretty likely that Palampolo will be the same way, where just some places just don't have a kitchen and they're still charging $1,300 a month.
Which is like, crazy, right?
They're like, a hot plate is included, though. A microwave and a hot plate.
That's not a kitchen.
My assumption is that we're like in the kind of like front wing of this place, because there is like, you know, there's the entryway where we come in, there's like a dining room slash like waiting room kind of where people mill, and there's like a that's kind of where maybe like entertainment happens, but then there's like a room where Hope and Bartholomew are in, that's kind of like maybe a more private meeting room, more quiet. But as we're walking around, we do see like we can actually peek in on Lightning and Snow. They're just like hanging out in a bedroom as Snow just passed out. You can kind of
He's like bandaged up, right?
Mm-hmm. There's some crappy art of what looks like bark on the walls.
We can get a little more context for Bartholomew too, because there's a data log for him where it just says he loves both his wife and son, but is clumsy at expressing it. Things are made even more difficult by Hope's rebellious age and unreasoning resentment towards his dad. Bartholomew has spent his days sick with worry ever since Hope and Nora were caught up in the middle of the purge.
I love the fucking data log is just like, yeah, Hope's just a dick.
Yeah, Hope's kind of just an asshole. We're like, what is the reason? Like, maybe he's an absent father and stuff. It's like, nah, Hope's just kind of a little shit.
Yeah.
He's 13 though, you know, like, what do you expect?
For sure
he wouldn't let me buy shit in Roblox or
whatever. He didn't give me money for V-Bucks.
I was just gonna say V-Bucks.
My brain has been
trying to get John Cena, Dad.
Have you seen John Cena use Kamehameha? Like, oh my god.
But now that like we've had like Corey on to talk about it, my brain's been poisoned a little bit, where like I never thought of the idea of like, oh yeah, you could just like write down everything about a film or whatever, and then look at it and see if anything has meaning, like whether or not it's supposed to be there. You know, you can kind of like infer things. And there is a photograph in the Estime household, right? That is of Nora and Hope. And the description of it is like, oh, his father must have taken this. His father must have been some distance from them. And I was like, oh, that's two things.
Yeah. So you can go walking around as Fang to interact with items and kind of get a little bit of exposition on the items. Like, but the one you're saying, I think, is like the two figures visible in this photo seem to be Hope and his mother. I think it might be like a picture of the area where Hope had a little quick flashback when he was with Snow before he tried to kill him.
Maybe.
Yeah,
it looked a little bit like that little overlook.
It looks like it.
But yeah, two small figures visible as photos seem to be Hope and his mother. Hope's father must have been at a distance when he took the picture.
Yeah, must have been at a distance when he took the picture. And I was like, oh, that means two things.
His skill as a photographer is really dog shit. The framing of it is awful.
The f-stop was too high, you know?
Yeah.
I think maybe because I'm spoiled by like all the kind of silly, like maybe overly emotional looking, like world building family portraits I see in like a lot of modern games. But the family portrait in this one just looks almost like they just pasted like the stock photos, like stock art.
Like the ones you would find on the Wikipedia or whatever.
It's like, this appears to be an Estime family portrait.
I was going to say, I think all my family portraits also look like we were just fucking...
They're all just like standing in their like idle poses, like completely separate.
Someone just cut them out of like magazines and stuck them together.
I literally have family pictures that one of my brothers had to Photoshop one of our members of our family into, because it's like, hey, we're all together for a nice photo. Oh, but Eric's not here. Oh, Carl's not here. So there's one that my mom was like, can you Photoshop Carl into this? And Eric just took a picture of my head and put it on a balloon that she was carrying.
It reminds me of these like visual novels on Newgrounds where they just use like the anime art of like someone like, hey man, how's it going? And just, like these two people sliding in just like their normal. Like,
oh yeah.
So they just look on Google Images and just found those pictures to use. And, but yeah, it's like a contented smile of Grace is the face of Hope's mother, but Hope himself seems to be in a sullen mood.
The face of Hope's father. I love that. It's like, yeah, like, oh, Hope's father seems warm and nice. Hope looks like a little shit.
Yeah.
There's the one that says like this would seem to be the apartment's master control terminal. It's elegant and modern design, but it looks expensive.
The keyboard for that is on the floor,
which
too.
Is
I was
wild.
Like, come on. Yeah, I was like, come on, what are you gonna work operate that with your toes?
Maybe they just have really strong toes in here.
Yeah, like, yeah, everybody in Final Fantasy can just type with their feet,
like foot pedals, you know.
Yeah.
A handful of academic texts and homemakers magazines occupy the otherwise sparse shelves, but none of Hope's possessions are to be seen.
Yeah.
Yeah, Bart just immediately threw it all out. He's like, well, my son's gone, so. Getting rid of that
shit. My son's dead.
He found out this morning. He was like, well.
That ungrateful little shit.
For this stuff.
Yeah, that's a weird house.
It is. It looks cool, though. It's
still super cozy.
Yeah. Very Hey Arnold.
Yeah, the thing that says the control terminal is, it looks like a freaking weird, like, chemo machine or something like that.
Like, yeah, like an upside down, like, teardrop shape.
I don't know.
Reminded me of, like, a Star Wars droid sort of style.
Yeah, right. Definitely. But there is something on the mini map that we can go up to and interact with, and it's just a TV
it's a TV that looks like a Windows Media Player skin.
Yeah. Oh my god, it does. Fang turns it on just by touching the screen, which is pretty sick.
And it's that guy, that same reporter's on the news.
Yeah, this is, but he's on the other side of the screen this time.
Oh, you're right. He's on the left side of the screen. Oh, my how
we have successfully
how the
pushed
turns
him
have
left.
Tabled. Yeah.
You can tell because he's no longer right now.
Yeah.
Now, for an update on the situation in Palampolam, the Lassie continue their desperate fight, and the military has now launched an all-out campaign to eliminate them. Desperate flight, right. You're right.
So they're on their way. They're trying to get out, yeah.
I was like, well, we are fighting.
Tomato, tomato, yeah.
In the event you must leave your home, please follow the instructions broadcast on this channel.
Yeah. And Fang looks at in the cutscene. She looks at the photo of the family and just says, "Must be the kid's family." and the report then continues, but it continues in a different scene. Like we're seeing the continuation of the news.
Yeah, Fang
broadcast.
Somehow turned on all of the TVs in the house instead of just the one that she was trying to watch.
Well, we know Lightning loves listening to the news.
On her birthday.
This is how she unwinds. This is how she relaxes.
But yeah,
gives snow healing powers, you know.
The scene is now inside the room where Lightning and Snow are. Snow's passed out, but he's
like a guest room or something. There's like these weird like IKEA lights on the floor.
Light seats.
Maybe you can sit on them. That'd be kind of cool. But yeah, once again, we got Instapol stats going on.
That's true.
The footage of the news is just a bunch of town people. Like, and when I say a bunch, it's not like a huge mob. It's just like maybe like seven people. And they're like brandishing weapons and they're like,
Oh yeah, but this says roughly 2,500 civilians believed to have come in contact with Lassie. But yeah, this bunch, I think, are part of the angry mob that was chasing Snow and Hope. Yeah. Before they're like, well, screw this.
Yeah, and it mentions that the ones who came in contact with the Lassie are now being held in quarantine, which is extremely dark knowing what we know about people who come in contact with things from Pulse.
Yeah, and as Lightning's hearing this, she's just like flicking that knife open and close that she got back from Hope. Just kind of like dicking around with it.
Knife goes in, guts come out.
Our latest Instapol has shown a vast majority in favor of the immediate purging of these individuals.
Boo.
But Snow basically comes to, and
but it comes with a free frogit.
Yeah.
But yeah, Snow is like getting up. He is bandaged up and a lot more slim than I expected.
Yeah,
him to
I've got a note here. Damn, Snow is vascular.
He's fucking like ripped. He's like shredded. Toned. I was expecting him to be big and bulky, you know, like a John Cena type. This is like
he wears a lot of layers.
Yeah, like he's just getting real baggy with it.
Yeah,
he has four coats. He has to wear all of them at the same time.
yeah, that's right.
Every time he gets a coat, he just puts it on.
All of his different weapons are not just like the sigils on the back. It's like a full different coat that he has to put on.
I do love that he is still wearing his bandana. bold choice.
Yeah, yeah, he is still wearing his bandana.
Wouldn't
yeah.
dare mess yeah,
but,
with the hair.
But Lightning's like, lay down, and he just is like, all right, and like just lays back down.
She's the one holding the knife, so like, all right.
Yeah. He's like, okay, it's now in the hands of someone who can kill me. Yeah, and Snow sees it, and he just goes, huh, I see you took the kid's toy away.
Yeah, and yeah. she says, he gave it back to me, said he didn't need it anymore. And Snow kind of just, like, lays on his back and looks at the ceiling and is like, huh, go figure. And you can kind of tell he has, like, a little bit of a smile. Like, he's like nice.
Snow, you've done it again. Now
yeah,
everyone
you've
loves
done it again.
You again. Back to having everyone in the world love you.
and then there's a very nice moment between Lightning and Snow where they kind of, like, patch up, right? And, Lightning's like, oh, I keep thinking about Sarah, like what happened to her, and I think, what could I have done? And I hated myself for not trusting her. And she kind of goes over like what she went over with Hope before, right? She didn't trust Sarah, and she felt like this was her fault and didn't know what to do.
Look, Snow. I'm sorry. Forgive me.
For what?
Everything.
If you told me your real name, I suppose I could.
And she looks at the camera and says, my name is Final Fantasy 13.
Credits roll.
Yeah.
or she says, my real name is Nora.
I'm you, but from the future.
Now, in this context, it's very cute, but in general, practice don't ask
yeah,
people
don't,
what their real name
yeah, don't,
real
yeah,
name
yeah.
is quote unquote just like if they go if they prefer a
if
name,
they
just,
prefer
just
to be
keep...
called something else just call them what they prefer to be called
it's easy for me Strunk is my real name so you know
from the Chunkler estate
exactly
it's a strong of Chunkler of the Chunkler fortune yeah but she says you can have Sarah tell you when she comes back and he's like deal.
Yeah. We get like a rare smile from Lightning because she's like chuckling, like, huh. Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. I like
it's
this.
It's very cute. It's very nice.
I feel like, oh, we have a team now. Like, because up until this point, from the very beginning of the game, all of our party members have mostly just fucking hated the shit out of each other.
Yeah, they had no frame of reference for one another, or they just straight up had nothing but like, and
they're all just stepping on they're all just stepping on each other, like trying to like get out of my fucking way, like, are like either trying to get away or running towards something. They're just constantly just clonking into each other and at odds. And
we got
it's
a
nice
rare,
that everyone's kind of converging.
We got a rare Snow apology this episode, and we also got an even more rare Lightning apology this episode.
Incredible. Wow. Incredible.
Love to see it. But they look over and Hope is kind of in the doorway and he just says, my dad said he'd like to see you guys. He wants to talk.
And it's a good way to like end the scene too.
Yes.
Because I was
like
oh
fuck,
boy.
Dude.
Yep, yep.
Hey, because dude, when this, sorry I killed your wife.
It's like, oh, this kid wants to kill me. Imagine what his dad would want to do to me.
Which is the subject that the scene comes up on, right? Like that is like the thing that happens.
Immediately, yeah. We're like, thankfully, Snow is wearing clothes again.
Yeah, I was confused as to what Snow does in the scene. I was like, oh, he's being a dipshit again. And then I realized I was being the dipshit because he's doing the Gomenesai, I'm sorry, like head bow, like get on your knees and ask for forgiveness thing in Japanese culture.
I feel like it is still a little bit awkward, just a little bit, because like when he does that, he does like a kneel and he bows and he's like, the blame is mine. I couldn't save her. And Bartholomew just puts his like head like down. He's like,
yeah,
he like does that. I was just like, oh, so now why don't you just shut up a little bit?
Well, it's also funny because they said he wanted to talk and like Snow is the first one
and
to Snow's
the first one to talk because he said
I was like, dude, like
have you learned nothing? It's fine.
He's learned a new type of high by accepting his guilt and apologizing for it and owning it. So he's like, I gotta get that again, dude. But Hope interjects and just says, if it wasn't for Snow, I wouldn't be here right now.
Yeah, yeah. And Bart asks them, like, did Nora say anything to you?
Yes, she twice actually. She said moms are tough.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah,
something about moms are tough. I don't remember the rest.
Like in Arrested Development, what did he say to you? What was the last thing that he said? I'm afraid I just blew myself. He said some really wonderful things.
Yes, and I was like, oh, she said to get him home and like kind of like nods toward Hope.
Yeah,
and Bartholomew's like, well, that's exactly what you've done. And, like, and so he's proud of him, so like. Yeah.
This is when everyone in the room just like lets out a sigh, like Lightning and Fang. I'm like, whew.
Yeah.
Like, damn, I thought this was going to be real awkward. Yeah.
This
yeah.
is going a better direction than I thought.
Everyone's buttholes just unclenched.
Yeah. That's right.
I also love that Bartholomew, because this is a Final Fantasy and most anime, like, his face, like, he sounds like an old grizzled man, but he looks like the grizzled age of, like, 35.
He's got a little bit. I did write down.
He looks younger
down,
than me, yeah. Like.
Oh, I did write down in my notes. I was like, Hope's dad, a little bit of a dilf. Like, he kind of looks good.
He has this very intense voice. He's supposed to sound very, like, high esteem and, like, whatever. Like,
but he looks like he's younger than I am.
Face to face like this, it's hard to believe you're all dangerous fugitives. And, like, Lightning is taking a seat, too, so everyone's, like, chilling out. And, I like that Fang is refusing, which is also like a big bisexual energy. Is just sitting on chairs wrong. She's just sitting on the arm of like the beautiful big chair over there.
Face to face like this, it's hard to believe you're all dangerous fugitives. But the entire world is scared to death of you, Lassie. No, not even just you. People who've helped you, bumped into you. Sometimes it's even just people who've walked by one of you. They think they're tainted and want every one of them purged.
And then Snow, like, jumps up, like, now energized by, like, cool, this dude's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like, yeah, like the Sanctum's a puppet of the Falcy. To them, our lives don't mean anything at all. We stop this.
Yeah, we'll stop
this. Take down the Sanctum and save Cocoon.
So good.
Yeah.
And then, and Bart is... delivers the most crushing line to him. He said, and you've thought that through. If the Lassie take down the Sanctum, fear of Pulse will only get worse. It won't stop fear. People will take up arms and stand against you. Can you imagine it? The rampant violence.
Yeah. Lightning says, when the government's control is gone, the citizens will revolt. And
yeah, like, which is a good point. Like, how would the public react to like the Lassie immediately just destroying the government?
Right,
yeah.
Right.
It's like, obviously that does not, it's not a good look, even if it's the right thing to do.
Yeah, even if it's objectively the right thing to do, it's like all of the indoctrination that we've seen in this world is just going to be like, no one's going to know that. They're just going to be like, oh my God, it's the apocalypse that we had all feared.
They were right.
They were right the whole
us.
Time. Like, yeah. Yeah.
Fang says, so what then? Are we just supposed to smile and eat a bullet? Because that means you too. And Bartholomew's like, hey, I know I'm a part of this. I'm on your side of the fence, harborer of Lassie and a public enemy. And and Hope's like, oh my God, coming here was a bad idea. Mm-hmm. And Bartholomew's like, no, this is your home. We're all here, so we'll figure this out together. Yeah. Which is like, oh, it's so good. But
Really nice moment, you know?
But that's cut short, sadly.
The power's out.
The power goes out. Yeah.
How inconvenient of a time for the power to go out, you know?
Yeah.
Those freaking, that freaking, the Psycon, we just, like, it wouldn't take much long to just follow the, like, the path of just destruction that we've been
right,
laying
to
wait
find
to,
them,
like,
yeah.
Right to this location. Like,
right outside. Yeah, right outside the S-theme residence.
Yeah, wasn't that, like, a flight, like, directly outside
the
house?
There's just, like, the fucking, the subjugator
the fucking
is just, like, yeah, on fire in the yard.
Its blood is pooled, and the footprints from that blood lead right up to the Asheim estate.
Where did they go?
But yeah, like, Lightning is immediately on her feet and just kind of looking around, and she hears, you know, some commotion outside, and we get a shot of just Psycom kind of, like, slowly making their way in, like, SWAT team style.
Right. And they throw in, like, tear gas canisters through the wall, or not the wall. What the hell is the glass wall called? A window? There we go.
Okay, cool. It's like a wall, but you can
look
through
it. What's the thing that Hey Arnold has on his ceiling that's like, it's like the...
Good, yeah.
The wall, but I can't actually hang anything on.
Yeah, what the hell was that part of the wall? The window.
Yeah, so they just kind of are breaking in and tear gassing everything, and Snow jumps up and he kind of covers his face and he just says, Hope, in the back!
Yeah, but he's like, clearly still injured. Like, for this scene and the next couple scenes, every time like Snow starts to move, you can tell that he still has like a serious injury, right?
Yeah.
And so and Hope's like, you're not ready for this. I'll stay here.
Yeah.
You go help my dad. And like Snow's like, all right. And so he runs back and tries to help his dad. I think that's when we take control of Lightning, right?
Yeah. We finally get control of Lightning again. We finally get 4 ATB bars again.
Yeah, that's right. And we're in, like, the area we get to run around in is just the Estheim residence, but there's, like, enemies in the hallway and shit. It's pretty wild.
There's a lot of cool...
And there's no ceiling!
And there's no ceiling! When you get into a battle with the enemies, the ceiling is gone, so you can do the launch attack.
Oh my god, I didn't even think of that.
Would it not be more effective to launch them into the ceiling and then back down again and launch them into the ceiling and back down
again? Oh, that
would
be badass.
That would be so nice if there was, like in kind of the inverse, like if like in Dark Souls where you can't, like, swing right if you're in a narrow, space. If launch did more damage if there was a ceiling.
Listen, there was a ceiling, but Psycom clearly just shattered it and started throwing down, you know, smoke grenades and shit.
We did it. We broke the glass ceiling.
What's the horizontal wall called? The ceiling?
It's like the floor, but I can't stand on it.
It's like the reverse floor.
Reverse floor.
Unfloor.
But yeah, these fights are pretty cool. They're not really all that... There's not really much to mention with them yet, I don't think, right? Like, it's just...
They're not too hard. We're
thrown into a fight with, like, two aerial troopers and a normal scavenger guy.
Yeah. I think they do respawn as well. It kind of, you know, the thing is that... Oh, wait, you know what? I'm actually looking at it, and... I mean, first of all, it looks like the living room got way bigger, but you can actually see the broken ceiling, like, the broken glass ceiling above us. Which I didn't notice at first.
But I think after that mandatory battle, we are now in the SM like normal hallway where the living room was, but there are still those encounters we can start. But it gives us a moment to save if we want.
Now I will say,
like, stock up because it'd suck if we can't like upgrade or like heal or coordinate before we jump into those fights.
Yeah. What the game wants us to do is there's a fight right outside the study, and that's where we're trying to get to. But if we don't go there and we actually go all the way to the back to the room where Lightning and Snow were, like right outside of that, there's actually items back there that we can grab.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, there's some items you can get.
Yeah. So I ran around like in a circle a couple times just like grabbing stuff. And there's only enough room in the entire map for like two different groups of enemies, and they will just respawn when you walk far away enough.
Exactly, you know. So I was like, oh, which is kind of cool because, you know, that we're kind of under siege right now and they're just kind of continually coming in.
Right.
So the respawning, I also want to mention, which will be relevant later, is that after watching Carl struggle with a certain caveat with a fight we may have to repeat later, is that even if you clear out the area and save and then jump into that fight, they will still they'll come back when you load the save
they
again.
They are back.
Oh, yeah.
No, really.
I think is actually, like, the more I thought about it, I was like, this is really bad design. And then I'm like, I see what they did here. I think... This is such a small area, and this is such a major boss fight that we're about to get up to. They probably had these respawning enemies as a means of being like, well, if you need to level up some, you can do that. You're not just locked. Hmm. You're not just soft locked into the game.
Yeah,
that's what I was thinking.
I ended up doing that as well.
Right.
Yeah.
And they also drop incentive chips, so you do get like money. So this is
an incentive to do it.
Yeah. Oh, very nice.
The items that you can get are the Brawler's wristband and an Aether Soul.
Okay.
So, pretty good.
I will say that the game, now that we have our party is Lightning, Hope, and Fang, it does give us just a absolute shit tier of paradigms, so you just fix that shit immediately. Mm-hmm. It's like, what if we gave you, like, the worst? Then I
kind of stuck with diversity and solidarity.
I kept diversity. I did keep that one.
Just to kind of, always someone attacking.
Yeah, so what we have to do is we just have to get to the study, which is pretty much right in front of us. We just can't interact with it until there's no battles around.
There's just, I think, the one group of guys that are right near it. So if you really want, you can just kill those guys and then go in.
Yeah.
And once the cutscene begins, the game kind of assumes that we've cleared the residence of enemies. That's kind of the...
Enough, at least.
Yeah, that's kind of the state that, like, it assumes it's in when the cutscene begins. Because, Bartholomew's like, oh, is it over? Are they? And Snow's like, they're fine. Your son is a tough kid, right?
Takes after his mom, who is tough because moms are tough. We do get a good look at his brand, which is looking good and closed.
Yeah.
So he's not in any kind of trouble immediately, which is good.
The shock to the system isn't doing too much.
they kind of peek out and see, the rest of the party there, and Hope is looking down, and he just sees that poorly photoshopped family photo just laying on the ground.
Right.
And he looks up and he sees his dad and Snow kind of coming out of the room, and then a very bright light starts to shine on them.
Yeah. I've realized that this is kind of some, maybe, I'm not sure how intentional it is, but some thematic poetry where... last time he saw his mom was with Snow, and immediately an arrival of the same type of ship.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point.
Oh, yeah.
The same, like, sky tank that with a giant fucking gun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, true.
That's what you need revenge on, motherfucker.
Yeah. Here's your knife back. Go after the giant tank in the sky.
Yeah. And at this point, they're kind of like, like, right before that light comes on, they're kind of in a little bit of, like, a limbo where they, like, wonder if any other enemies are around. And once that light shines, you can kind of see that there's several SCICOM soldiers outside.
Quite a small army, a battalion, as Fang says, which does the very Josh Whedon-y, like...
Who ordered the battalion?
Yeah, I wrote down Josh Whedon DreamWorks smirk. Yeah.
She said that, and I was just like, ooh, I'll have what she's having.
Yeah.
Like, shut the fuck up.
But it's kind of cool because of the way, like, the house is entirely dark and there's that bright light shining in.
All the windows are blown out and shit.
Yeah, like, it's like... The members inside, like our party members, they can't look out the window to see what's there because they know that there are soldiers there who will shoot them if they're seen. But on the soldiers on the outside, it's just a completely dark, empty residence. So there's like this weird standoff with nobody attacking and nobody shooting because they're like, oh, who's going to make the first move? How do we get out of this? And it's a very tense scene. And I was thinking about it and I was like, I don't think since 13 there's been... scenes like this, or even like before, really. Like, this feels very like Call of Duty, you know what I mean? Like, we're in like a house, like fighting. I was like, I don't think there's been a fight in a house since Final Fantasy 13.
We've been so outside of like the whole like civilian settings and like for all this whole game. And it's really weird, like being every other Final Fantasy, we've never really been like a residence when we were fighting enemies, I don't think.
We fought in Don Corneo's residence.
I guess the closest I can think of is fucking, like, Cloud's whole home getting, like, burned down or some shit. Like that. That's kind of outside
of our... Or everyone's home getting burned down in Final Fantasy IV.
Right. Yeah, this seems almost like a fucking like thriller movie. You know what I mean? At this point.
Yeah, it's very cool. But Lightning kind of, you know, sees what's going on, and she just says, they'll take out the whole building next.
Oof.
Hope runs up to Bart and just says, Dad, and like they have a moment and they grab each other. And Bart's like, oh my god, thank goodness, like, are you hurt? And he's like, no, like, how about you? It's still in one piece, you know. They're exchanging a moment and we're all together now and just facing down this thing. And if only someone could have a plan to get us out of the situation.
Snow comes up. I actually like, this is probably like the best snow scene to me thus far, I think, actually.
I really like this, but I also think it's dumb as shit.
Oh, it's my favorite one. This is like the one time I'm like, okay,
in a way
cool.
That snow being dumb is expected, but I'm just like, dude, like, you could have easily just fucking died here. Like,
oh yeah, no, absolutely.
He says, my turn, and he gets up and he like runs forward and he's like near one of the blown out windows and he just grabs his coat and holds it up to the window and they just fucking light it up. And I'm like, dude,
arm is right there. Shot his fucking arm off.
Your hand is right where your head is. I'm sure someone's gonna be aiming for that.
Yeah. I can't believe he doesn't get shot in the arm. Yeah.
Yeah. Again, suspension of disbelief.
He's wearing gloves. It's fine.
but after they're done shooting, or actually not even after they're done shooting, while they're still shooting, Snow yells out,
don't shoot.
And they stop. Like, they stop shooting for a moment. And he's like, I'll show you what a lessee looks like. And he steps out the window. Like, he steps out in front of all the guards who all have, like, guns trained on them. And they actually, like, you see a bunch of the laser sights, like, all converge, like, right on his head. And he, like, looks up at him and is like, ooh.
I can only imagine the thought going through their head is, damn, lessees are hot. Like, whoa.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. He snow walks out and you're like, damn if I cut. Become a lessee, do I get cut like that? Holy shit.
Me. I'm a lessee. Surprised? Expected some kind of monster? I'm flesh and blood like you. An ordinary citizen of Cocoon. Don't you get it? This has been our home our whole lives. How could we even think about destroying it? We want to protect this place just as much as you.
He's on our side?
This is very unrealistic.
Yeah, exactly. I'm just like,
I'll go use facts and logic to deal with The police state.
Like, I've seen people get, like, fucking thrown to the ground for trying to give, like, roses or something to the cops in, like, a show of, like, a peace offering or something.
What was that fucking Pepsi ad they tried to do?
Yeah, I think it was Kylie Jenner
Pepsi ad, yeah.
Yeah, but he's basically saying, like, how could we think of destroying this place that we have, like, we want to protect it just as much as you. This is our home as well. Like, you know, like... Let the madness end, you know.
Yeah, right.
We do hear murmurs from the cops. I'm like, it's like, is he on our side? Like, no, he's lying. Like, really? He's like,
yeah. And they're like,
it's effective on them. Yeah,
it is. Yeah, but Roche is a part of him, and he's like, you know,
we get a shot of his. Roche has got some high heel boots.
Yeah, his shoes are looking real nice.
It makes him look real tall. He's got the pumps or whatever. Yeah. The lighting in the whole scene is really cool because he just like...
Oh, it's so good. It's so cinematic.
They're all reverse lit by the like sky tank.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he's coming forward and introduced himself like, Snow Villiers.
You must be Snow Villiers. Yeah.
Yeah. Jarg Roche, Psycom Division. I understand your plight. However, the poster is not so easily dismissed.
The very existence of Ulysses puts every last one of us in danger. Tell me, do you really think your life is worth more than the lives of millions of Cocoon citizens? I do not.
Which, I will say, there's a bit of a jump in logic there, mm-hmm. where, like, I feel like Roche is, on purpose, skipped a step there, like, why does Lassie put every one of us in danger, right? Like, how exactly does Snow living...
I didn't put too much thought into it of, like, his motives here, but I kind of read it as like, oh, like he's
been fed the same Kool-Aid everyone else has.
He's just, he really believes this indoctrination, like to the point where he's reached like the higher echelons of like the military because of it. So like, I'm sure he truly does believe this, and I think thinks he's doing is righteous and good. But
I was just trying to own him with facts and logic, of course.
Yeah. The song that's playing here is really nice. It's very like Hymn of the Faith kind of.
I can't believe it.
Oh yeah.
We just talking about me. You're right. There is a very great song playing right now, but we missed my favorite track, and I didn't even mention it. I cannot believe this.
Is it the weird breakbeat music that
can
plays?
Can we back up just a second? There is a sick fucking like drum and bass, like an acid, like a 303 like playing. That plays during all of the raid on the S-Time Resonance section.
It's super good.
When you get in fights, they blend it with Blinded by Light. So, like, the main theme of Blinded by Light is, like, a couple steps up. And then, like, as soon as the refrain stops, instead of going back into the dunce, dunce, dun, it goes like...
It's really fucking like, good.
Oh, it's so good. it's so good.
I think they use that in one of the trailers for this game because it sticks perfectly from like, yeah, like this cool action movie thing that feels very of like the 20-aughts.
It does, yeah.
Just look up the Ben Affleck Daredevil trailer, and it's very much like, oh yeah, post-Matrix like movie trailers. Dude, that, are just like this.
That movie introduced me to Evanescence.
But yeah, that into just as the raid's happening. But yeah, now we're in like with Roche with this very triumphant like Hymn of the Faith kind of. I think it's like one of the fallacy themes. You might have heard it when we were branded for the first time.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
Or a variety of that. There's a few tracks that have this kind of very godly, holy vibe to it, which I think works because, you know, Sanctum is basically working for the fallacy, or they're using the fallacy as kind of a device or a crutch.
Yeah,
or
the fallacy is using them or something. Who knows? But Roche just says, and so it falls to me to order your execution. Is that simple? It is my responsibility to see you put down. I will knock you down.
I will knock you down.
Your lives are forfeit. And Snow says, cut the crap. You want Lassie, then kill Lassie. why do other people have to die? The purge has got to stop.
Yeah, and Roche is like, do you think we want to purge our own people? Which I think he's being a little bit...
I think you want to do that, yeah.
He's acting a little... he's on his high horse here because we've seen Roche literally be like, yeah, you can just shoot civilians,
yeah, just
it's fine.
Yeah, shoot people for fun, that's fine.
Yeah, you know,
you've
shit.
Had a hard
Fuck
day,
him.
Dude.
Like,
just
don't lie to me, Roche. I've seen
that's
you talk
not
to
okay.
your man.
Yeah, Roche, you fucking asshole.
But he's easily like... just rustled, because like as Roche is turning around is like when Snow's like, ah, cut the crap, because Roche is like kind of like conversation over, but as soon as like the purge has to stop, like Roche is like, oh, like
yeah,
I can't believe this guy's getting under my skin. Like
as he's going into his next bit, we see some grenades that are kind of flying above them, like from behind him. But he says, yeah, like if any trace of Pulse remains, the populace will erupt into chaos. Without sacrifice, without the purge, Cocoon will die. And then like he sees this all going on, like these grenades, and he's just like, who fired? I gave no order. And like,
yeah,
things
like
are just,
they're tear gas grenades. They go off. They like land in front of him and actually go off. And he
quickly starts getting out of control, and all of his soldiers just start getting like mowed down by something.
Right, yeah.
We see, like, and from behind him, one of a Psycom that is probably not one of his comes up and freaking just lights him
right the fuck up.
Bye, Roach.
Yeah, we get to see, like, a nice dramatic, like, thing of, like, the shell, like, the casing just, like, falling to the ground, like, the spent casing and stuff.
Yeah.
As Roach falls.
And then we see from...
It's weird that the smoke covers, like, the Psycom's, like, helmet as if, like, we can recognize them or something.
Yeah. But so, like, I couldn't really tell if, like, this was, like, one of his members who was there. Like, were there, like...
defecting?
Were there, like, a couple...
kind of seeing through the illusion.
Either that or if it was, like, some kind of inside job or whatever. Were they already in that group or did they come from elsewhere and are now attacking these guys? I couldn't really tell.
My god, Psycom was an inside job.
Yeah.
I thought it was gonna be like part of Sid, like we'll find out later, I guess, but Sid's men, but they kind of just disappear.
Well, I think that is the implication.
Yeah,
it's just that we don't see any of the like of our quote-unquote friendly Psycom as soon as this next scene goes out.
Yeah,
until like later. So like, that's wait true. Where do they all go? Yeah. Until like,
yeah,
where did the surviving Psycom like force? Unless they just all just somehow wiped each other out.
We do get a scene from inside where we're seeing through the shattered glass windows, and we see like all of this happening. And Fang kind of looks relieved, and she just stands up and she's like, "Okay." We hear a Psycom soldier scream like, "Fall back!" And Lightning just says, "We're leaving. Hope, tie up your dad.
Yeah.
We threatened you and forced you to help us. Got it." And
I love that. I love
Bart's
that.
Like, oh, there must be something else. And Hope just says, "Do what she says. I can't let you get dragged into this. I want to stay here, but there's no place for a Lassie. I'm going with the others. We'll survive somehow. I promise you that, Dad. I hate to run out on you." And Bartholomew just has a very like proud dad moment, and he just says, "You're not running. This is not running away. You've made a choice. You'll survive and do what needs to be done." And Hope says, "You mean complete my focus?" And he says, "Don't you worry about that. You make the choice." And
I love that.
Hope just says, "Thanks, Dad."
I do feel like that's like very like the "you make the choice" or whatever is very thematic to 13 overall, because that's like the problem the whole game is like, what
we
are you free
no
to
agency.
Do?
We have no choice.
Yeah. So
yeah, but Hope and Bart have a good big hug. Hope says, "Thanks, Dad," and which is the thing that we always used to say to my art teacher in high school. Anytime he complimented us, people would just go, "Thanks, Dad." But then we see Snow outside, just in a big cloud of tear gas, just coughing it up. And
I love this scene so much. I think it's so funny because, like, yeah, Snow's like injured in the middle of a bunch of tear gas, and he's like, "All right, I'm gonna fight him. Here we go. I'm gonna kick these guys' asses." And Lightning just kind of like is like, "Look, it's our turn, hero. Like, kind of like, you hang back." And Snow's like, "What? I can handle a little gas." And Hope runs in front of him and just goes, "Catch your breath. I'll throw in some hits for you."
Yeah,
and I'm like, oh, it's so good.
There's a great moment earlier where they Hope and like Snow like just do a total like handshake, like total like solidarity.
They do, and it's so good. I was like, Hope and Snow on the same team. They do a handshake. Let's go.
Yeah, I think that's before he like goes out and throws his coat out. But it was like really, it's really like hard. I'm like, oh yes, they're like.
I know that I smiled so big. I was just like, ugh, love that. Good energy
Snow,
with this part of the
you
group.
You son of a bitch.
I'm glad that all of our party has come together and that there won't be any more inter-party drama,
strife.
Especially not immediately after this.
Yeah. And it's good that we don't have a huge fucking obstacle in front of us after this newfound friendship with everyone.
Speaking of an obstacle, yeah.
We are face to face with the gunship that was flying right on up to us, which is called the Havoc Sky Tank.
Love this guy.
This thing sucks.
This is a motherfucker.
Sure is.
Yeah, and I think I... Poor Carl, you were struggling on this. I think it took you a while to realize that there was multiple targets on this
enemy. That was my problem. I was like, I'll just attack the big guy. It's fine.
So what happened with me is I was like, okay, there's a lot of thematic things happening. We just had a fight where we, you know, had to kind of lose to get it to the next phase. I was like, surely we're not expected to have three of our friends take down a giant fucking Call of Duty ass like sky tank.
This is a very Call of Duty battle. You're on a fucking like the roof of an apartment, like fighting
and just like as all of this like was attack, like all the attacks were just doing insane amounts of damage within like the first couple of seconds of it. Fang was knocked out. I'm like, this is probably just a mandatory loss. And then who knows? Hope, here's Hope's Eidolon scene or something. And nope, I just got game over. And I was just like, what the fuck? And I was like, oh, you know what? It's Final Fantasy 13, so we don't have to worry about, you know, like getting game overs. And then no, you're thrown back in the house and you have to watch all those cutscenes. I mean, you can skip the cutscenes, but you have to fight some of the guys again and then go out into the place where you start the cutscenes. So I had to do that quite a few times because I didn't really realize what the fight wanted me to do until 5 minutes into the fight where I like beat it.
Yeah, I got mowed down even knowing that, like, after seeing Carl's turtle, I completely got mowed down like on the first go, like immediately, because it fucking hits hard and fast, like just constantly.
It does, yeah.
Yeah. So the basic strat for this fight, I think, is that it has like the main target that you can do that is just like the default one. But if you look closely, and by closely I mean if you just look at it at all, you can realize that there are
stop hitting X the whole time.
Yeah, stop just spamming X out of panic and fear. You'll see that there's several like starboard, whatever, like port and starboard, like I forget
gun
what they're
turrets.
Called, but there's different targets. Yeah, different turrets and different targets. So you can cut down on the damage that it does to you while also dealing a huge amount to its like overall health bar by focusing on the smaller, easier to handle targets first.
I love when you actually take down a part. Like you'll like hit the final hit on like a turret, and instead of doing your normal like 2,000 damage or whatever, it'll do 80,000. It's like, oh my god.
So I think, actually, I'm watching back my playthrough of it. I think the first time I got into this fight, after watching all those cutscenes and stuff, I was like, okay, clearly I fucked this up. Fang's out, Hope's out. I'm gonna chalk this one up to a loss. That's fine. No problem. And I just went in and hit retry. I was like, yeah, whatever. I'll just retry from the start. And then I had to do all that and I was shocked. And then I got back into the next battle and I got fucking destroyed by it. And I was just like, okay, that's gonna be mandatory death or whatever. And then I was like, oh my god, this fight is just unreasonable.
You know what my technique was?
What?
Aegisol.
Oh, okay. That's what you were talking about.
Oh,
yeah.
Nice.
No,
yeah.
That goes into the does it last through the cutscene.
Indeed.
It does. So, like, as I first gamed over, it was like, oh, it's fine. Like, I can load my save up and it'll be fine. But just going to the fight with, like, Shell, Veil, Vigilance, and Protect all up at the same time for everyone, like, okay, now we're going. Because it can't get rid of them because it's a fucking mechanical enemy. It's not, like, a magical enemy. So all those things stuck on me, and I just stuck to like solidarity and diversity, and just whittled down each part of the
nice
turrets first, and then the
hull.
The hull.
Great.
That's right. Yeah.
So looking back at my footage, the first fight I died in 45 seconds. the second fight I died in about the same, and the third fight I was like, all right, how are we gonna do this? So in your equipment selection area, you can select whether you want like balanced offensive and defensive, and I select balanced for everyone. And I was like, that's fine. Set my paradigms so that I had Hope ready to start protecting and shelling everyone, and Fang is a sentinel. Hope's protecting and shelling and all that kind of jazz to everyone, and Lightning is just in Commander, just as Curtis would put it, making the stagger bar sticky. Like, just that's sort of the aim. And then the second I had the chance, you know, Lightning, Hope, or Ravages. And then the second anyone got low on health, I was like, okay, cool. Is it Combat Medic or whatever it's called? Where you've got
Combat Clinic, yeah.
There you go. That's the one where you've got Lightning and Hope both as a medic. And then everyone will just heal up and then wash, rinse, repeat sort of style. The second, because when your buffs start to start to flicker, like that, obviously you need to re-put them on. So it was essentially like switch back to that. And it was that. That was the plan.
That's how I ended up doing it. I had a panic button one. I basically had my bottom one was Lightning was a medic, Fang was a sentinel, and Hope was synergist. Mm-hmm. And that was my panic button where I would, so like when I started, I'd do one round of normal like Ravager, Commander Ravager, immediately switch to that to get everybody's buffs up. And then I would just alternate between like solid attack and diversity. So I'd do like two turns of Ravager, Commando, Ravager, and then two turns of Ravager, Commando, Medic, and just alternate those two the whole time. And that pretty much took me all the way through. And then when I saw that my Protect was going down, I would go back to my Panic button one real quick and get all the buffs back up and just rinse and repeat. Now, finally, I did have to do this battle three times. I beat it on my third time, and I lost my second time. My second time I did it, I died because I got down to the final chunk of the boss or whatever, but it wasn't in stagger. And I was like, you know, its health is really low. I'm almost certain that I can just, you know, because I want the good time. I want that lowest time, right? So I'm just not going to diversity and I'm not going to sentinel. And I think I can trade blows and beat him. And we fucking had a draw. I threw magic at him that would have been the one to kill him. And then he shot me and like it killed me first. And I was like, no, I had it. God damn it. I was right there. So that's how I lost the second time that I fought him. And I beat him the third time. The first time I went against him, I had just Uber Eats to McDonald's, and I had my and I had my fries sitting on top of the keyboard, and I pressed escape.
The tummy hurt reveals itself.
Yeah, and so I went to grab some fries, and the box like kind of like fell down a little bit and hit escape, and I was like, oh no, what am I supposed to do? And I hit enter, and that's how you close the game out. And I was like, no. So I did it to myself. I did it to myself both times.
Okay, so I'm trying to look back at my footage to time it all out. And 2 minutes in, when I was just panicked, like, attack, like, buff up as much as possible, like, keep healing, like, stay on top of it. Like, the time I finally, like, won, I was like, oh my god, I'm such a fucking idiot. It's been so long since I've had an Eidolon character that I completely forgot I can just summon. Clearly the thing that the game is telling me to do, because I'm getting my fucking ass kicked, is summon Odin. So I summoned Odin, and I saw all the huge numbers on the screen from all the targets getting hit, and I was like, okay, that took me 2 minutes of fighting to realize that I could just summon Odin. That didn't kill it, and then it took me, I think, another 2 or 3 minutes to realize that there were extra targets and you could just focus on those, and I was just like, oh my god, I'm such a fucking idiot. And then I still barely squeaked out a win, and I did not get a good score at the end of it.
Yeah, my score was very, very generic.
My ending was very satisfying, because after I had taken down the starboard and port side hull, and all that was left is the center, I think there was like maybe like a fifth of the HP left on the bar, because I think once you take out those parts, like that actually takes out some of the total HP.
Yeah. It takes 80,000 damage. Yeah, it's a ton.
So I immediately like, oh yeah, I'll do what Carl did now, and like summoned Odin, and I was able to like finish it with the big finisher, and like that was such a satisfying
thing.
That's
like, cool.
Zantetsuken on a giant machine.
Yeah that's like, awesome. And,
because like this, the score screen comes up as she's handing like the sword back to Odin. Mm. And it's like good. And that's
that's so good.
It's like, yes, nailed it. Like,
I'm looking at mine, and not like, I don't even know.
Battle duration 5 minutes, so it still took.
That's faster than mine.
Oof. Yeah.
I was gonna say
that's great.
I'm also on easy mode, so
it took me 3 minutes.
3 minutes
to summon Odin, and then an additional 5 minutes to finish the fight. Mine was 8 minutes and 53 seconds, so I got 3 stars. The target time is 10 minutes and 8 seconds.
Oh, interesting. My target time was a little bit higher than yours, yeah. Actually. It was interesting. My target time was 11 minutes, 13, and 6 minutes on the dot.
Damn.
To the second, baby. Mwah. Well, I guess not to
gotta
the second. Well, no, yeah, this is the second, yeah.
My target time was 12 minutes, 22. My battle duration was 12 minutes and 29 seconds.
Ah, by seven.
We're still got 3 stars, though.
Did you attack any of the turrets or anything, Strunk?
For like 5 minutes, I didn't at all.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I was like, oh, there's other things here. And so like the last 7 minutes was just killing everything.
I love experiences like this in video games because it's very Dark Souls to where you're like, you're just completely fucking confused about anything that you're supposed to do. And then it finally clicks and you're like, oh, okay, I know how to do this. So like when you run through the game the next time, you're like, this is all, I already learned everything. I'm fine with it. So like the next time I do this fight, I will just destroy it, probably. I'll be able to get 5 stars like with relative ease compared to like what I did this time. But learning it was the fun part because I was just like, this is impossible and I can never do it. What is this game asking of me?
I'm still, I've said it multiple times, but I'm still so excited for a certain boss fight or two in this game that'll be coming up.
Oh, I've heard.
I don't know how to get past it. It just, sometimes it works out for me and sometimes it doesn't. So like, I'm very excited to share that with y'all.
I've heard people talk about bosses that just make them hate this game. So I'm excited
for this. Yeah, there's a
couple. For spoils, we get Uranite.
I saw that. I was like, Uranite. It's like Uranite or something
Uranite,
like that.
Yeah, Uranite. And we also get Plautus'
workshop.
No,
Uranite. No, Uranite.
Yeah. Yeah.
Myanite?
But yeah, Plautus' workshop.
Yeah, I opened that. I went to that afterwards.
I did too, and I forget what it is. I think I also read the...
Oh, I do remember what it is. It's, they sell weapons, but unlike the other store that sells like...
Up in Arms, yeah.
Yeah, instead, like Up in Arms sells like this one has more attack, this one has more magic. Plautus's sells like this one has better stagger duration, and this one has like those kind of
okay,
weapons.
Okay, cool, nice.
Plautus's workshop. Brute force may win easy battles, but readiness wins them all. Our master craftsmen produce only the finest in specialized weaponry, getting you the edge that separates the best from the rest in peace. Discerning customers agree. If you want quality, you want Plautus.
That's funny because like the copy is actually pretty accurate to what they sell. So
yeah,
that's kind of fun.
It's pretty good.
Anything else about the sky tank?
No, I think just the cutscene of it falling.
The first one was hard.
Yeah, the first
oh,
sky
yeah,
tank
the first
was
one
difficult.
Was really hard.
It wasn't time with the second one, guys.
Yeah, yeah. What was the time on the second one? Like 10 seconds.
Second phase. Let's go.
We get a shot of our team kind of watching as the sky tank is falling from the sky. It's on fire. It's destroyed. We kicked its ass.
I assume it kills a shit ton of people below.
And then probably. And then immediately another gigantic airship kind of rises up in its place. I don't think it's quite as big as the skyship, but I was just like, this game has got to be fucking kidding me with this. Like, I was half expecting to actually have to fight, but. Fang just like covers her eyes a little bit and she goes, again, there's no end to these guys. And it kind of just pulls closer to where we are. And then we see a giant beam of light blast through it and take it down from like far away, like from almost like from the ground level or from above it at a diagonal.
From above it, yeah.
Yeah.
It's the charge laser, but from another ship.
Yeah, from yet another ship. The one that consumed the power of these other two and is
this one wants the glory.
It. Yeah.
And a bunch of SciComm members run out of that one, right?
Yeah, one of the ones trailing behind, slowly sauntering up as the other guys are running up, has his gun held really cool on his shoulder, just kind of like cockily walking up, and he just goes, "Hey, a Fang."
And he removes his helmet, and it's Kurt Russell. Incredible.
Yeah,
that's Sebastian Stan.
Sebastian, yeah, the Winter Soldier guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, her old friend.
If you have a... speaker name enabled. It says his name is Rigdia.
Rigdia.
Which I forgot that you can enable because I was.
I did not know that you could enable that. I did not.
You can turn
that.
On. You can turn on speaker name because I was like watching a play. Like, wait,
that would be so fucking helpful. How many fucking hours? We're 13 episodes into this shit, and now I'm just learning that. There's been so many times if you listen back where I like skate over who is saying the thing because I'm watching footage of it on mute and it doesn't have their name. God damn it, dude.
when Rithia takes his helmet off and we see that it's him, he says
he has kind of a Cid from FF10 kind of voice.
I could see that. Yeah, it's a little
the final showdown with Sanctum.
Yeah, right. He's got kind of a little bit of a twang.
Hey, you Fang. Need a ride?
Don't get cute. Right, let's move it.
And then I love it because, like, I feel like all of Palimpolum has kind of been revolving around this. I like that, like, one of the very, very last thing that happens in Palimpolum is Hope looks back, sees Snow walking up, and Snow does like a thumbs up.
He's like in pain, so like
he's in pain.
He's in so much pain, dude.
But I like that Hope looks back at him and just kind of smiles and nods at him, and I'm like, yeah,
it's really good.
They patched it up.
And now they're best friends forever.
Love this for them.
Hope looks over his shoulder and says, take care, Dad. And we do a little crossfade, and we see his dad now with Psycom escorts, who may be friendlies but undercover.
Yeah.
Kind of just monitoring him to, like, probably to help sell the story that he was taken up against their will.
Yeah.
Right.
Quote, unquote. So he doesn't seem like an accomplice.
Yeah. And then we get another vanille narration. It says, when it comes to home and family, we never keep either as close as we should. Whoever stops to think that this time could be the last. A little ominous.
Oh, so good. I love it.
Yeah, but we see the ship taken off that we're in.
Yo, how long is Palimpolum as a section, though? Holy cow.
3 episodes long, I think.
Yeah, we started with Corey and then...
Continued with Corey.
And then did... Wait, is it 4 episodes long? Because we had Corey...
Corey was in the place before Palimpolum, right?
But that is neither here nor now. We have Strong with us.
Yes.
And thank you to shove us off and get so we can get the hell off this horrible town.
it's done enough to all of us by now.
What a doozy.
Where are you at right now, Strong? Are you just caught up with us or have you played ahead?
Yeah, so I'm like maybe 10 or 15 minutes past this point. Like, we're just sort of exploring the Nautilus at the moment.
Yeah, Nautilus says we mentioned that, like, right after this, we get to catch up with Saz and Vanille, who are now at Nautilus City of Dreams.
The City of Dreams, baby, with the dream team. Nothing could possibly go wrong.
Without our Gold Saucer episode, which always ends well.
Yeah.
Actually, that was, like, the thought that went through my head as I was walking around. I was like, oh my god, this is just the Gold Saucer.
Yeah.
But better.
Yeah. Without describing anything that actually happens in the next episode, I will say that my first note for the next episode is... the world's saddest people at the world's funnest place.
It's just not a very happy birthday for Rex Banner.
not a very happy birthday for Saz Catsroy.
No one at Nautilus, they've barely touched their banana kaboom.
So good. Thank you so much for coming on, Strong. I really appreciate it.
Thank you all so much for having me. This has been so incredibly fun.
Yeah, it's been a good time. What are your next plans for streaming, speedrunning kind of thing?
So at the moment,
I'm excited about what you're doing right now.
It's spooky season. And so last year I did something called All Out October, where I tried to just play through the main 13 Final Fantasies in October.
Yeah.
And didn't get very far. I got all the way through to like halfway through 7, I think.
That's still pretty impressive.
Not bad, yeah.
Not bad, considering I hadn't played a lot of them. And it was great fun. And so this year I decided to do it again, but this year we're doing Zelda. So we're playing through 11 of the main Zelda games. And so far, because as you might have heard, Australian internet is not good. it started off incredibly poorly, but we're here and we're ready to go. The original NES Zelda is not easy at all,
No, it is not.
I have tried playing it multiple times, and here's the thing, is I've like...
Open world games have only gone downhill since then.
Well, no, that's the thing, right? It's like, I've found and seen many things in that game, but I've never found Dungeon 1. Where is it?
Dungeon 1?
I found it entirely by accident. I found Dungeon 6, I think, first.
Yeah, I think I found like 5 or 6 or something first, and I found like other ones. Where the hell's Dungeon 1?
For me, and I never liked looking it up because I always like to play with what I call like playground rules, you know, where you don't look anything up. I can never find Dungeon 2. I always do 3 before 2 because I can always find 3. However, I mentioned this to you on your stream.
You did. Strong.
Friend of the show, Robbie of Zaku, once found this at a thrift store and got it. He's like, yeah, I don't really have a need for it, so I'm just going to give it to you because he's like the ultimate homie. But it is the Legend of Zelda inbox with the map.
Oh, wow.
With the manual, with the gold cart. And I was like, yo, Strong, do you want me to just scan every page of the manual and just send it to you? Like, it's super sick. But also, there's just this...
It's probably on archive.org, honestly.
Yeah, it's true. It probably is.
Yeah.
But this is more personal, you know?
This is a present from Carl.
Anytime you need anything, Strong, I'll just show it to... Yeah. Just come to my stream and I'll
pay you in the audio of me saying Mojo Jojo.
Yeah. Yeah, so just look... There you go. There's there it is right there, Curtis. Dungeon 1 right there on the map.
Perfect. Excellent. I'll just screenshot this and
The one on the island there?
Yeah. Now, it's going to be confusing. The way I'm seeing it, it looks like it's mirrored. I don't know if that's the case on yours. If it is, that's going to be even more confusing. But
Hold up your right hand. Okay, no, it's fine.
Is that my right? Yeah, that's my right.
Yeah, it's fine. It's good. That's correct to me then.
My right or your right?
The dungeon's on the opposite side in Australia.
Yeah, this entire thing's been very weird upside down. I'm not going to lie to you. But yeah, we're doing that all through October, so we're going to see how far we can get. We got a couple of sub goals. One of them is to
Strongtober. Let's go.
Strongtober.
That's such a good name. Oh my god.
Alex should come up with names to things more often, like podcasts.
One of them is to, if we get far enough, we're going to chase Curtis's Sailor Moon speedrun time.
Oh.
And if we get even further, we're going to do it in Sailor Moon cosplay.
Oh, that's so good.
Super cool. I'm looking very forward to it.
Yeah, everyone go follow and subscribe to Strong. It's always a good time on Strong's stream.
Thanks, friend.
Absolutely.
You're a very pleasant follow, honestly. It's a very
stuff. Thank you, guys.
Speaking of which, where can people find you on Twitch?
twitch.tv/strongchonkler.
Same for Twitter.
And also, I think it's also on all of my socials as well. Twitter is strongchonkler, I want to say.
Yeah, and we'll put it in the episode notes and all of that.
Thank you. It is 11:30 in the morning. This has been perfect timing for me.
Nice, that's great.
I woke up at 1 p.m.
Nice.
I think I did too, actually.
Wait, that might have been like... That's when I usually wake up, I think, is like 3 a.m., which is 1 p.m. your time.
Wow.
Mm.
That's probably about right, yeah.
Yeah, well, thank you again for coming on.
Yeah, thank you all for having me. This has been just an incredible amount of fun.
Yeah. We'll have to come back sometime.
If the queen just needs to have another birthday, all right, we can catch up every single time.
Get her ass.
She's got another year left in her.
Just got a little more gas in that.
I have something unfortunate to tell you, Alex.
To shreds, you say.
How's Prince Andrew? Oh, to shreds, you say.
Well, Alex, would you like to
hold your coat out and get shot in the hand a bunch?
I was going to say tie us up and then threaten us that we had to work with you because we're not actually culpable.
Would you like to show us what a Lissy really looks like?
Oh, much better.
Yes. Thank you, Masashi Amuzu, as always, for the game music.
Especially for all the music this time. Mm.
Yeah.
Oh, really so we didn't even talk about like the nice little... classical guitar piece that plays in Hope's Home.
All of Hope's themes are like acoustic guitar. It's really nice.
So really good.
I do love like all the different like instrumentation for every character. Like Saz has like the harmonica.
Yeah.
Hope has acoustic guitar. I think like Lightning is his piano usually.
I guess that makes sense. Yeah.
Vanilla has a little also like kind of more of like a twinklier piano as well.
Fang has didgeridoo, as we all know.
Wow! 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 Wow!
Oh, I should have brought my didgeridoo down for Strong. Damn it.
You have a didgeridoo? That's so much better than what I've got. I've got nothing.
Yes,
You can rate us, review us, subscribe to us on iTunes, Spotify. You can also do the same on YouTube now if you feel like. I keep forgetting to mention that. We have a YouTube channel, which you can, like, yeah, leave comments on individual episodes.
Yeah, it's a much easier way to yell at us if you want.
It's a much easier way to correct us than to do it in the Discord, to where we may mention that 2 weeks later, and then yeah. It'll be impossible to find by the time you hear it.
Doing it in the Discord is like saying it to our digital faces, so there's a little bit more, like, danger. With the YouTube comment, it's like, okay, well, at least Google's in between us.
Hi friends, this is your local daddy and mommy expert, Sweet Matter. And speaking of mommies, I have this suspicion that a certain celebrity has named her child Snow. Earlier this year, Kylie Jenner and Travis Scott had a baby boy that they named Wolf, but they were like, hey, haha, never mind, we don't like this name, so we have a new name for him. But they never really announced that name, and I never really cared about this one until recently. And one of the Kardashian sisters, like, they have this child, and they apparently blurted out this name, and the name that they blurted out was Snowy, which matches the sister's name, which is Stormy. So, like, do I think that they named their baby Snow after Snow Valyrs from Final Fantasy XIII? Well, heroes are apparently named Snow, and we sure as hell need a hero in this world. I don't know. Bad conclusion. Okay, bye.
Wait, that ties it all together as well. Do you know why they named their daughter Snow or whatever? The reason that they went with the name Snow was because Snow is the character who hands Psycom a Pepsi, just like in the commercial that Kylie Jenner was in. I think that's...
Yes.
Was it Kylie Jenner who did the Pepsi
thing?
Yeah. Thank you so much for the call-in. We have to have Sweet Matter on for a special Dad's Day episode.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sweet Matter is our daddy yeah. expert.
Yeah.
She's been our kind of a correspondent for rating whether or not a character that appears as a daddy or not.
Yeah, we were
dad out of 10.
we were talking about if Bart, I think she had said, I'm trying to determine whether Bart is or is not a daddy. And then when it got to the point where they're like, Hope, tie your dad up. I was like, oh, Sweet Matter's going to be parked up. I'm gonna tie up the daddy, dude.
We'll have to do a daddy tier stream or something like that.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
But yeah, thanks for calling, Sweet Matter. Yeah, so you too can leave a message at 530Materia. But you can find us at every FNFF on Twitter, Instagram, and join our Discord, and on YouTube. And I've got to save her and get her back home.
To podcast, you mean?
To grand podcast.
Okay, actually, goodbye. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.